But the greatest revelation and the greatest identity, the most intimate relationship on earth, is that between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife. And the Spirit of God is releasing this revelation that Christ is the bridegroom and the church is the bride.
Now, he is actually receiving messages from God, and he's writing these messages down. Give me an example of one of the messages.
A couple of months ago, he woke me, right this morning, he said to me, "Mommy, Jesus spoke to me last night about his word and he's coming again." And these letters is on the website, you can see it there, which is going to be very, very, very soon. "Do you know that, Mommy?" And then he would tell about the bride. Jesus wants to come and fetch his bride, but his bride is not ready. And I tell you, this is the bride today. We're all in church. But Jesus did not come to give us religion. He came for an intimate, passionate love relationship with a king. In heaven, there's a golden bridge. And after the bridge, there's a huge door with pearls around it. He says that there's people standing outside and they're crying. I said, "Why are they crying?" He says, "They can't go in." And I said, "Into what?" He looked at me and said, "Don't tell me you don't know." I said, "No, I'm not sure." He says, "There's a wedding feast inside and everybody's not ready."
And I remember yelling out loud, revealing the condition of my heart when I cried out, "No, we're not ready." So I come out of this encounter and I find myself back in my physical body. I'm on the floor, weeping, totally distraught and disturbed by the encounter. And those words haunted me, said for 2 hours.
"Do not be afraid. When judgment falls on this world, my church will no longer be on the earth. I saw seven angels, each one of them holding a golden bowl, and seven other angels, each holding a trumpet. Lord, who are these angels?" The Lord answered, "The seven bowls that the angels hold are filled with the wrath of God. They will soon be poured out, and when the trumpets sound, my church, those Christians who live according to the will of my Father, will be caught up. They will no longer be on earth during the great tribulation. Before the Antichrist manifests himself, this man of sin, my church will hear the last trumpet sound, and they will meet me in the air." I was there, dear friend, in front of a great throne, and I did not have any notion of time. A moment later, Jesus showed me how his church, the true believers, will be caught up. I saw this in vision, thousands of people disappearing. This happened worldwide, and TV and radio gave the news of the disappearance.
"What will the world say about people being raised up in the air, Jesus?" He gave me accurate and detailed answers.
NASA of the United States will make an announcement that thousands of UFO from a distant planet in the universe surrounded the entire Earth and abducted numerous people around the world with a powerful ultra-modern sucking machine in one moment, promising to make further investigations into the matter and trying to cover it up.
People were perplexed in this situation that Jesus mentioned before. That is, people were abducted, and those who were left behind were talking about it in surprise. Going into the house, she yelled, "Mom!" She was looking around the house to find her mom, suddenly stopping at a point to realize what happened. A devout Christian, her mom always reasoned with her, who ignored her persuasion and regarded her stories about the end of the world as a joke. Then she had a realization. It was not an abduction case by aliens from a distant planet, but the rapture. Her mom was raised into heaven, and she was left in the world to face the tribulation.
Will those who received Holy Spirit go through the tribulation?
Those who love Lord and those who are loved by Lord will suffer from hardship very likely if they enter. They will not go through the 7-year great tribulation. Lord will calling them before the 7-year great tribulation. They will be ready as brides and spread the last gospel with the love given by Lord. Then, they will be lifted in a cloud simultaneously.
Then what kind of people will be left in great tribulation? Will they include those who received Holy Spirit?
There are few believers are left also in order to help others with God's permission.
What kind of people will be left behind generally?
They will include those who listened to God's voice and regarded it as a joke, or refused to believe it. They will be subject to severe, harsh, and deep suffering in the great tribulation.
Lord guides many martyrs to martyrdom for that. They will, of course, receive rewards for glory and nobility as I saw them at the place of martyrdom. Why aren't they thrown in prison?
They are in prison because they refuse to receive a mark on the forehead. Believers refused to receive a mark on the forehead.
Does that mean it is 666? Not answering the question, he said,
a microcomputer chip will be installed in their foreheads. Those who do not have the mark will have a difficult time eating, dressing, and drinking. However, those who were chosen by me will know it in advance and refuse to accept the mark, going through some difficult hardship regarding eating, dressing, and drinking.
Lord, talk about the statement the Pope made a while ago. Why did he make such a statement? My questions concerned the statement that only Roman Catholicism is the true church by Pope Benedict XVI. Regarding the issue, Jesus said in a resolute tone,
it is one of Satan's strategies to establish a world government. Roman Catholicism is showing its true colors to advocate and help him before Antichrist appears. Calling Mary was a practice to serve Antichrist as an idol. Now they declared that only Roman Catholicism is the only church in order to muster strength and force to establish a world government.
Lord, save the souls in Roman Catholicism. Jesus said,
didn't I tell you? I never lose a soul that belongs to me. It is your role to spread the book among them diligently. I will make claim to the souls of my people reading the text and save them.
Our conversation resumed about the end. The Bible says that we should be awake and pray since the end of everything is near. What does being awake mean exactly?
It means devoting oneself to God's words and prayers. Those who love me will find me through prayers. Those who want to listen to my voice will do so by reading my words. I will meet those who love me. They will listen to my voice who wants to hear my voice.
Someone asked me how those who received the Holy Spirit could be thrown into hell. He said he learned that those who received the Holy Spirit once would have nothing to do with hell forever.
That is why I keep saying that you should be awake. Being awake requires balanced faith. Devotion only to prayers will lead to spiritual arrogancy. Devotion only to God's words will lead to intellectual arrogancy. It will be desirable to balance between them in terms of faith. Especially intellectual arrogancy can easily result in heresy. Good examples include Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons. You get to fall in heresy while trying to unfold the words of Bible forcefully.
On May 8, 2005, he's minding his own business, sleeping. What happened?
And then all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, my spirit begins to rise up out of my body. And at first, I was just like hovering, hanging over the bed. I could see my physical body laying there. I could see my wife laying next to me. And I thought to myself, what in the world is going on? I thought I had passed away. That thought went through my mind. Then all
I could understand.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, I feel these two massive arms. And I knew it was an angel. And I could see myself. He was cradling me, holding me in between his two arms. And the moment I saw that, we begin to rise. And I remember looking at the roof and I ducked my head because I thought I was going to hit my head against the roof. And to my surprise, we go right through the roof of the house. And so that's when I thought, oh Lord, I passed away, and I began to pray for my wife, my kids. So for a brief moment, my mind and my thoughts, my emotions were on earthly matters. And then all of a sudden, from one instant to another instant, in a moment, my emotions were flooded with this incredible joy. Joy I had never felt before because I knew that I was about to go see Jesus, the Son of God. And so I remember just closing my eyes and thinking to myself, I'm ready. And then we shoot through the atmosphere, going through the clouds. And then in an instant, I find myself in this big open expanse of a place. So for lack of a better words, a large opening, a room. I didn't see any buildings. I didn't see any angels. I didn't see anybody. I just saw in the natural, I'm colorblind. So I saw these incredible colors, massive, beautiful colors. And the unique thing about that, Sid, was the colors were actually breathing. There was life. Like if it was lungs, it was expanding and, you know, inhaling, and I could see the colors actually breathe. And from that room, all of a sudden, in an instant, I was back into this other room. And in this room, I saw two figures, and they were standing at an angle like this. I was maybe from here to the camera, maybe 10 feet. And then I heard a voice, and the voice said, to you, it's been granted to stand here and listen. Because I immediately recognized it was the Father and the Son. At first, I didn't know who that was, but as I got a little closer, then I heard the voice, I recognized it was Jesus and the Father, and they were having a conversation. And so when I heard the voice that told me, you've been granted permission to stand here and listen, I remember turning my ear this way to listen to their conversation, and to my surprise, they were talking about the end times. I remember hearing clearly that they were talked about the difficult hour that lay ahead and how the church would be given the opportunity to be purged and the opportunity to really experience the greatness of what still lays ahead, the greatest outpouring of the Spirit of God. But clearly, the way the download that I was receiving as I heard all that reminded me very much of this, the readings that that you do on an annual basis as a regular Christian, and the end times, the book of Revelation, the book of Daniel. So I remember listening to this conversation, and I was brought to my memory was all the judgments that are coming based upon the book of Revelation and also Joel, the book of Daniel. And but I received, and I felt like this is an hour, an opportunity for the church to be stronger and to understand the importance to be ready and alert, because my sense is, for the most part, the body of Christ, for the most part, is not prepared for what is about to take place.
Okay. Do you think you'll be alive when all this happens?
I firmly believe that I will be alive. I believe that my eyes will physically see the coming of the Lord. And when you study church history, those who remained on fire for the Lord, even the Apostle Paul and Peter, they believed in their day, in their hour, that they would see the coming of the Messiah, the coming of the Lord. And I feel like the church must understand once again end time eschatology. We must be students. We must understand the signs, the seasons, the hour that we're living in, so that we can live an urgent life. And when we have that understanding of sense of urgency, our hearts, our lives are completely given to the Lord. I feel like there's a greater surrender as a result of understanding the hour that we're living in.
Okay. But then the most terrifying thing that ever happened to Carlos happened to him in heaven. What happened?
Well, what happened was they went from discussing about the urgency of the hour, they went to discussing about the greatest outpouring of the Holy Spirit, greatest miracles, not all gloom and doom. There's great hope. But then the hope culminates in this incredible manifestation that I believe the Spirit of God is doing right now, and that is this. I heard the Father say to Jesus, "It's time, son. Go get your bride."
What did that mean to you?
At first, I was shocked and stunned, but I had this download and understanding of revelation that I, as part of the Church of Christ, in that moment, I was not prepared, and I was not ready to really see him come back. Even though we may have the right confession, we may have the right lingo, we may say the right words, but in reality, for the most part, many of us in the church, including myself at that time, I was not ready, was not prepared. And so when those words came out of the Father to the Son, I remember this, it was the most horrible fear. It was, I call it the terror of the Lord. The most horrible fear and terror that ever I had ever felt. It was like those words rolled out of his mouth like a ball of fire. And I remember those words just rolling towards me, and I knew it was gonna hit my midsection. And when it hit my body, I remember trembling violently, and I couldn't contain myself. And I felt that these words, something was gonna come out of my mouth. I tried to hold myself back, and I couldn't. And I remember yelling out loud, revealing the condition of my heart when I cried out, "No, we're not ready." That's what I did. I raised my fists
up
like this.
You weren't even thinking this.
I wasn't even thinking.
It came out from your innermost. If this man is not ready, what about us? I'll tell you what. He was downloaded from heaven how to be ready. Now, when he says ready, he doesn't mean repenting of sins. He repented of his sins. He doesn't mean having the Messiah live inside of him. The Messiah lives inside of him. When he said, "I'm not ready," he meant, "I am not prepared to be involved in the next, in the greatest, and perhaps the last move of the presence of God, of the mercy of God on planet Earth." And he was commissioned on what he had to do to be ready and what you have to do to be ready. After thinking about this and pondering and taking time, why were you not ready?
So I come out of this encounter and I find myself back in my physical body. I'm on the floor weeping, totally distraught and disturbed by
not
the encounter.
Ready.
And those words haunted me. I said for 2 hours, I lay there weeping and saying, haunted by those words, no, we're not ready. No, we're not ready. So I asked the Lord, Lord, why am I not ready? Was I talking about myself, the ministry, my family, the church in general? And after 2 hours, I heard the Holy Spirit say this to me. He says, son, if I took you home right now, you are ready to meet me for eternity. But then he said this, but in the condition that your heart is in right now, you are not ready for the next great move of the Holy Spirit. And so here's what the Lord began to reveal to my heart. He began to reveal to my heart that I had become a professional minister. In other words, I had become grown so comfortable in my calling that the ministry was routine. I mean, you can get up behind a platform and, you know, my heart was still for the Lord. Don't get me wrong. I still love the Lord. But in other words, my heart was no longer on the edge, a prophetic edge. And the Holy Spirit began to reveal to me, he says, son, you've left your first love. It reminded me of the church of Ephesus in Revelation 2, where the Spirit of the Lord rebuked the church for leaving her first love. Although they had great ministry, they had great doctrine, great miracles, but they left their first love. And the Spirit of God began to reveal to me, son, because you've left your first love, therefore there's a lack of humility. And the lack of humility, which I believe is a major component that we have to have restored in the preachers of America, the preachers of the Western Church, the preachers in the body of Christ, so because the true spirit of humility is a pure dependence upon God, where there is no glory for man. There is no glory for the church, or a specific local church. There is no glory for a ministry, but he gets all the glory. And the true spirit of humility is that what John the Baptist said, I must decrease, but he must increase. And so I really believe this is an area that the Spirit of God is honing in on so that the church can understand if we truly are humble, he will exalt us. And there's many that are watching right now by television that the Holy Spirit is, I saw earlier the Spirit of God almost like take his hand and turn a spigot. And I saw a fresh release of affections. I saw a fresh release of love. And those of you that are watching right now, just be sensitive and ask the Lord. Say, Lord, would you please open up the portal of my heart? Open up the portal of my soul, because the Lord wants to download a love and affection. He wants you to feel how much he feels about you. And the reason why many of us are stuck, we're not progressing, we feel like we don't feel the presence of the Lord, or we're not happy. I mean, some of the saddest Christians are Christians who are bored. And they're bored because they don't fully realize how God feels about them. And so for those of you that are watching right now, I just say in Jesus' name, receive that fresh turning of the affections of God for your life, even right now in Jesus' name. And so I just felt from the Lord that the Spirit of God was asking me to focus on two things. Son, become more dependent upon me. Seek my face. And then number two, return to your first love.
Carlos, you have started a 7-day-a-week, 24-hour prayer meeting in Orlando. A lot of people, when they hear things like that, they say, I am so glad you were called to pray. I'm not. I mean, I'll pray my prayers in the morning for a couple of minutes, but that's your thing, not my thing. What would you say to them?
I would say to them that the Bible is very, very clear. Every one of us are both kings and priests. And a king ministers in behalf of the King of Kings, but a priest ministers to the king, to the priest of all priests. So I would say that we must return back to ministering faithfully at the altar.
Like King David,
the altar of prayer and the altar of worship. We need to have every believer understand, wait a second, it's not just the pastor. It's not just the evangelist. I'm called as an individual to return back to minister to the Lord. And that's what I believe the Lord is saying. Return back to your first love. The greatest commandment is not a suggestion. It's a commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength. And when you look at the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, it's about one thing, Sid. You ready? It's about a wedding.
A wedding.
It's a wedding. In other words,
a lot of people, to be candid with you, I know what he's saying, but I have never really thought about it. Did you hear what he said? From Genesis to Revelation, it's about a wedding. Explain.
History began in Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3 with Adam and Eve. What's that about? Man and woman becoming one. That's the wedding. First miracle of Jesus, is of his ministry, where? John chapter 2, at the wedding of Cana in Galilee. And then one of the greatest apostles, if not the greatest apostle, was Paul. And he has his revelation of the mystery. You know about the mystery, the Jew and Gentile becoming one. But he takes it further, and the Lord reveals to him, this mystery I'm talking about is the heart of God and the plan of God coming to pass from all of eternity, which is what? God and man becoming one. And he uses the picture of a husband and a wife. He says, I speak to you a mystery, but I'm speaking concerning Christ and the church. And then we have Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. One of the last statements that the Spirit of God says about the end times is this, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. I believe the greatest identity that's about to be released to the body of Christ. We know what it is to be a child of God. We know what it is to be a son of God. And many of us know what it is to be a friend of God. But the greatest revelation and the greatest identity, the most intimate relationship on earth, is that between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife. And the Spirit of God is releasing this revelation that Christ is the bridegroom and the church is the bride.
You know, I'm reminded of another wedding. At this particular wedding, the very first miracle the Messiah of Israel demonstrated, he turned water into wine, the wedding at Cana. And this is what his mother, Miriam, said. Whatever he says, do it. That's what Carlos is talking about. That's what Carlos heard from heaven. But you don't know what he said if you're not reading his word. You don't have a revelation of what he said if you're not praying. You don't know anything if you don't have intimacy with God. If there has ever been a time,
yes,
that you must have your own intimacy with God. Someone can't do it for you. You've been lied to. You must have your own intimacy with God. Believe the Messiah of Israel died for your sins. Believe that his blood, the Pesach blood, the Passover blood, washed your sins away. Believe that you are clean and he lives inside of you and is your Lord, and start doing whatever he says. Do it!
On It's Supernatural. It should have been a deadly car accident, but it was actually a miracle in the making. See how a young boy died and went to heaven on the night of the wreck. And see the amazing gift from God that Odu and his mother are sharing with the world.
Hello, it's Sid Roth here. Welcome to my world where it's naturally supernatural. My guest from South Africa, she was actually Mrs. South Africa. Good marriage, wonderful children, wonderful career. Everything is perfect. And one night, her husband is driving the entire family, and her whole life shattered. Explain.
Yes, it was a very bad car accident. And after the accident, we all fell out of the car. And me and my husband tried to figure out where the children were, and they wasn't in the car anymore. So I ran around in a dark night to find my children, and that was really the worst day of my life, to realize they were not in the car anymore. We found the little one, and he was first out of the car. And then he was explaining later to us, because he only had a couple of bruises and cuts, mm-hmm. that Jesus caught him. And the moment he said that, I thought, you know, we taught our children nice. I didn't take right. it serious. And then I found my son at the opposite of the highway, on the other side of the highway.
But it was dark. How did you find him there?
You know, I was running around, and everybody that stopped just called out his name, and he didn't answer. And as I was running around, I asked the Lord, Lord, help me. And the next thing, the Spirit of God just led me to the other side of the highway. My husband said to me, you would never be there. It would never be there. It's too far. But I ran, and I just fell over his body. So I spoke to him, but he was already in a coma, so I thought he was dead.
But you were also concerned that another car might hit you. It was coming toward you, and it's night. What happened to you at that moment?
While I was busy with him trying to figure out if he was alive or not, a car tried to avoid the accident scene and where all the people stopped. So he went in the bush, and this is where exactly where we were. So I jumped up because I realized this car is going to drive over us. And as I jumped up and I looked into the lights of the vehicle, a very strange thing happened to me. My whole body starts shaking, but not like when you're cold. It's like really, really shaking. And I was looking at this lights of this car, and the next thing after the shaking, the heat, it's like fire. I could tell where it went. It went right through my whole body. And after that, I could say it's here and then at my feet. And right after that, the peace of the living God was with me. And to have peace in this worst situation,
it's almost impossible to imagine.
Absolutely. But that is when the presence of God is there, then you have that peace.
And of course, your son, you could see, was dead. But you found out later, when you were having that peace, what was going on with your son?
When I had this peace, he was in heaven. Jesus, what happened actually there later on, after he was in a coma for months, and he came out of the coma, but he couldn't speak. The only thing that he could do was write. And then he was explaining while he was writing to me. That night, on that accident scene, I looked into Jesus' eyes, the Messiah's eyes, where he took him, picked him up, and took him to heaven, where he was in heaven the whole time. And God was teaching him the word of God is today in his heart.
Did he know the word? Did he know the Bible before?
Oh, not at all. I mean, he was so normal, 12-year-old kid.
So while he was in heaven, the whole word was downloaded into him?
Absolutely. Today he can tell you any scripture. He can, when he writes, he would just download scriptures. And there in heaven, the time, and he also said, you know, if you did not surrender me, Mommy, to Jesus, I would have been dead. And so, yeah, that the whole...
How did he know that you surrendered him to Jesus?
For me, that was the strangest part, because he could not, because he was in a coma in my eyes. But while he was on the machines, and they told me they're going to stop the machines, I ran opposite ICU. I stayed in a room. I ran into the room and I did a strange thing in my eyes. I took my jacket and I pulled it over my face. And I didn't know it then, but today I know this is like a prayer closet. And I called yes. out to the Lord.
And that, we Jewish people used to take our tallit and put it, and so we still do it today, over our head. And that's what Jesus did
yes.
when he said, go into a closet, meaning
yes.
the tallit or prayer shawl over
yes.
your head.
And then God spoke to me, you know, audible voice, and he said to me, are you willing to surrender him to me? And I really was not ready, but God asked that from Abram, and he asked it for all of us, because he was like an idol in my life, and God don't want us to have idols, and he wants to be our first love, and that is why I needed to surrender him, and that is why he could know that I surrendered him to Jesus. And he said to me in this letter, if you did not surrender me, I would have been dead.
Hmm. Well, you know, the thing that is really hard for me to comprehend is when I look at your book, A Message from God, it says, I want to dedicate this book to Dwayne and Anton in heaven. What is this all about?
Well, the time while he was in heaven, God showed him the whole place and the houses and the children and the babies and everything. And then he came back. And one day he starts writing about the two children he saw in heaven. So he gave the addresses of the parents, and he was telling about both children, how they are so happy in heaven, but they do not want to come back. But their children are worried about the parents. Have they ever surrendered their life to Jesus? And he gave this little letter and say, your son is happy, he's healed, he's complete, but what about you? So I was really thinking, this medicine is too strong. How can this be? And I just kept the letters separate. And one day a friend visited us, and he was writing because he couldn't speak, and saying, "My mother's not obedient to God's voice." And I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Those two letters." So this friend of mine took the two letters.
Well, how could you find these two kids that he met in heaven?
He gave the address. He says...
He had the address?
Yes, he says...
How could he know the address?
It's impossible.
Hold that thought. Let me tell you something. This is amazing. And when you find out what Aldo is writing, messages from God, you will be... I mean, this is so wonderful. Not many books will I read twice. This is a book I want to read many times because it's God, the life of God and your intimacy with God. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Hello, it's Sid Roth here with Rita McPherson. And Rita, this is such an amazing story. Your son literally died. He went to heaven. He came back with the Word of God downloaded in him. He didn't have it before he went.
No.
He knew two young boys that had died, and he wanted a message to go to their parents, and he knew where they lived.
Yes. But
when he came back to life, and you're nursing him at home, what was wrong with him physically?
He had a very bad head injury. So with a head injury, he had a midbrain, brain stem, the left side, the right side. He couldn't walk, he couldn't talk, he couldn't speak, he couldn't eat, he could do nothing. He could really do nothing. That's why we took him home. They actually gave us an address and said, book him in there. But we took him home because I knew what God said to me. God said to me, I'm going to heal this child. And this child is going to tell the world that Jesus is alive. So I took him. We took him home and we nursed him. And for months he was blind. He couldn't speak and anything of that. But while we were keeping on speaking life into him, God was healing him day by day by day. And then eventually the one eye opened, but the other eye was still blind. And after the nurses left, he slept in front of my bed. And that night he woke me. He couldn't speak. He was writing. He woke me and he said he wants to write something. He said to me, "Did you see Jesus?" I said, "No." He said he was right here in the room. I said, "No, I had a dream." Like you speak to Jesus, but in a dream. He says, "No, Mommy, he was here. He touched my eye." And the first thing I said to him, "Can you see now?"
Of course.
And he says, "No." And I cried out to the Lord. I said, "Lord, I need a miracle now." He says, "No, you need faith now." Faith. And then 2 weeks later, as I came back one night, that blind eye was still open because every night you had to put salve in to close it. And the blind eye was open, and I was just kneeling and praying softly in my spirit to him. And afterwards, I just give him a kiss like this, and he did it back. And the blind eye was open, and the other one was asleep. And I asked him, "Loud, can you see me?" And he just showed me, yes. And he kept on writing. He said, "I told you he was here, and he touched my eye." And there I realized God's timing is just different than ours. But what God started, he will complete in our lives.
Now, he is actually receiving messages from God, and he's writing these messages down, and you have these messages in your book. Give me an example of one of the messages.
One of the messages was, a couple of months ago, he woke me, he wrote this morning, he said to me, "Mommy, Jesus spoke to me last night about his word, and he's coming again." And these letters is on the website, you can see it there, which is going to be very, very, very soon. "Do you know that, Mommy?" And then he would tell about the bride. Jesus wants to come and fetch his bride, but his bride is not ready.
Tell me about, because this is amazing, when he was weeping one day about the golden bridge.
Yes. He can't cry like he normally cries. So he would just make noises, and he was laying his head on his arms and crying. And I said, "Why are you crying?" He says, "In heaven there's a golden bridge. And after the bridge there's a huge door with pearls around it." He says, "But there's people standing outside and they're crying." I said, "Why are they crying?" He says, "They can't go in." And I said, "Into what?" He looked at me and said, "Don't tell me you don't know." I said, "No, I'm not sure." He says, "There's a wedding feast inside and everybody's not ready." So every day he will journal a whole page. That next morning he only did this. He wrote Matthew 25 and he left for school.
And he should have not even known what was in Matthew 25.
Well, I didn't.
So what did you, you read it immediately?
Yes, I ran to my Bible and I read it, and it was about the 10 virgins.
Five wise, five foolish.
Five is wise and five foolish. Five is ready and five is not. And I tell you, this is the bride today. We're all in church. But Jesus did not come to give us religion. He came for an intimate, passionate love relationship with a king.
I've got a question for you. You went in South Africa to a good, born-again, charismatic church, the best in the city. Mm-hmm. You certainly heard the truth. What is the difference between you today and when you were Mrs. South Africa and going to the church? What's the difference?
The difference is sometimes we sit in a church and we think the church is the place where we can get everything, but you get knowledge. And the fruit of knowledge is works. And I think the church today, and the church is me and you. You know, I'm not talking about a specific church. It's knowledge gives you works. The fruit of knowledge is works. But the fruit of the Spirit and the fruit of a rhema word is an intimate love relationship with a king. And the difference is that we keep ourselves busy with works instead of with a king.
So today, how have you changed? What's different about you?
My whole life changed because the night when God revealed himself to me, I found out how much he loves me. And it's all about love. And because God loves me so much, I can walk this walk of faith. And because I know now his character, I can trust my whole life in his hands. And I can just give everything to him and just seeking his presence all the time and not seeing what I can do for him and try to impress him with my works. It's a different thing. It's a whole different thing. And now the peace is always there because his presence brings peace. And as you push into God's presence, there you'll find the miracles, the signs, the wonders, the broken heart healed, everything that we ever need on earth.
But you had an encounter from Jesus about this book. Don't go away. We'll be right back on this. Hello, Sid Roth here with Rietta McPherson. And Rietta, this is such a wonderful thing that has happened in your family. But the book was ready to come out, and someone put some doubt in your mind, mm-hmm. and you prayed for all you were worth, and you had a visit. Tell me about
yes.
that.
I really said to the Lord, I said, Lord, you know what? I don't want to doubt you. I don't want to put something out for faith, but I need to know, is this what you want me to do, the book? And I cried that night, and Jesus himself came into my room, and the Shekinah glory just filled the room. It was white, white glory of God, his Shekinah glory. And then I spoke to him. I said, Jesus, is this you? He says, yes. I forgot about the book. I said to him, just tell me, why are you so good to me? And he answered, he says, because you love me so much. And then he says, the book. He says, give me back the book. So I saw myself giving Jesus the book. So he took the book just like this and he blew his spirit in the book because we all need his ruach breath. And he did that and he gave it back to me. He says, everybody that read this book will receive my spirit. They will feel my spirit, and my spirit, the spirit of truth, will open up this truth to them.
Okay, I can tell you when I read this book, I could literally feel the presence of God pushing me into a greater love relationship
yes.
with him. It's books new, but are you getting reports from other people besides me?
All around the world. I tell you, the first thing, and this, then I get tears in my eyes, because the first thing people will tell me is, I could not leave the book, and the Spirit of God really spoke to me all the whole way, and I felt the presence of God and the Spirit of God. And that's all that I want to know, because this is exactly what Jesus told me will happen.
You were at the UN, and there was a beautiful mosaic, and God spoke to you. Tell me about that.
The February, just before the accident, me and my family were visiting New York, and we were at the UN, and I looked at this mosaic. I did a strange thing. I said to Alder, come and stand here. Let me take a picture of you. at the back was the mosaic. And as I took that picture, the Spirit of the Living God spoke to me, Rema words, and he says, all the broken pieces of your life is nothing more than a beautiful mosaic of your future. And this is what me and my family are busy doing now. The Holy Spirit created a new life for us, and we have to take the pieces of your life and create a new mosaic.
In your book, you talk about it's either let God create the new mosaic of your life, or go back and grab the pieces and try to put it together yourself, and you cut yourself.
You will find these two people. The one will ask the Lord to help you to put it all together and create a new mosaic. The other one will also gather the pieces, because that's part of trauma. And you will gather the pieces, but you will find after a year when you pass there, you will see there's blood and they are bruised and cut, because they have not start building this mosaic. Life is like that. You have to make a choice with what you have in your hands. Pitiful or powerful, you can't be both. You have to surrender your life to God, and God will help you to create this mosaic. All the broken pieces of our lives, what you see, is nothing more than a beautiful mosaic of your future. And this is life.
Now, there was a message that I read about that your son talked about from Revelation, and he said, we are the Laodicea church. What did he mean?
Yes, one morning he was writing and he says, Mommy, you have to go and tell the world that Jesus says, this is the Laodicea church. My husband asked me, what is the Laodicea church? I said, this is the last church in the book of Revelation. So I went to the Lord. I said, Lord, what do you want to tell me about? I was in a church that Sunday, and I said, what do you want me to tell the people? And I was starting telling the people the Sunday about the Laodicea church, and I said, you know, he was explaining. He says, cold or hot, but now you're lukewarm. And the Spirit of God stopped me. He says, no, wait. What do you people call cold? We say in South Africa, we said ice cold. And if it's hot, like fire. And the rest? Lukewarm. So you can choose today. Are you ice cold, or are you fire hot? Hot like fire.
And what does he say will happen if we're just like everyone else?
The lukewarm, you see, and this is where you don't need God. Everything is so great in your life. And this is what the book of Revelation says. He says, I'll spit you out of my mouth.
But you were like that.
Exactly.
I mean, you went to church, you would consider yourself a Christian, but
exactly,
you were doing it yourself.
You see, God wants us to
your
have
way.
His fire. He wants us to have this fire of God inside of you. And if you're sitting today and listening to us and you don't feel the fire of the living God in you, you have to know, you have to push in. There's more. There's more than just being born again. There is the fire of the living God. There's an abundant life that he speaks about in the Word in John 10:10. He says, I sent the Messiah so that you can have life and life in abundance. And that is right now for us now. But we have to push into his presence. And we have to want an intimate love relationship with the Lord. And then you realize you can do nothing. We need the Lord.
Not only do we need the Lord, you need the Lord. You need to know. You could be going to a church, a synagogue, a mosque, but do you have this intimacy with God? This passion you can't work up. You can't do works. It's a gift from God. But this is what the Bible says. If you draw near to God, and of course you must draw near to him in truth, and there's no other name given unto men in which we must be saved but the name of Jesus. If you draw near to God, he says, I promise you, I will draw near to you. So step one is to tell God you're sorry. You're sorry for all the sins, all the unforgiveness, all the unbelief, all the lack of trust, all the things you've done wrong, and all of those hurts. Just give it to him. Tell him you're sorry for what you did wrong. You're sorry for the way things are going. You're sorry that your mosaic, that beautiful picture, is all shattered. and you're ready to let him put that mosaic back together. And what you need to do is to tell him you're sorry, ask him to forgive you of all of your sins, and come and live inside of you, and let him create the greatest mosaic the world has ever seen. You are a masterpiece, because I'm looking at you through God's eyes right now. I'm not looking at you through what you, the mess the world has made of you and you've made of the world. I'm saying those broken pieces, you can be in a self-pity party, or you can say, Holy Spirit, I give up. Make a masterpiece out of my life. I want to love you more. I want to know you. I want to go to that great Jewish wedding. And Rita, if you have never been to a Jewish wedding, you don't know what fun is. But I'm talking about the Jewish wedding in heaven. You have an engraved invitation. Just accept. Yes.
What happened during the Great Tribulation? Lord showed me some events that would happen during the Great Tribulation. Vision came to me during a prayer with powerful anointing. Now I realize that God surprisingly showed me them one by one in order of happening. Those scenes are vividly recorded in my head like yesterday's dream, even after some time. Vision 1. There was a boy sobbing and wiping out tears with his fist at the entrance of a shabby building, which had no front door, commonly found in general modern buildings, but dark stairs leading directly to the second floor. I approached him, who was squatting at the entrance and crying, and asked him, "Why are you crying?"
"The doctor's gone. Jesus took her,"
said the boy, still crying and not even looking at me.
"She told me to believe in Jesus and go to church. She also said Jesus would soon come to take us. But he only took her, with me left behind."
My eyes then caught the doctor's clinic. It was located in the upstairs of the building. I could see her room. The young and sincere female doctor left her clothes thrown on the chair. God showed me a fantasy in which she stroked him in the hair lovingly and preached the gospel to have him believe in Jesus. I realized why God showed me this vision first. God was worried about young children more than anyone else. Children who do not believe in Jesus cannot get raptured, so they're left behind in the world and should undergo great tribulation with distress and pain, including young children like this boy. Knowing this well, God's heart is breaking more than anyone else. If children are left to do whatever they feel, like such as computer games, they can be addicted to the games and their spirits will be taken by the demons. It will be such huge trouble. Children should start receiving education through Jesus Christ and be faithful at an early age so that they will be lifted up in the sky when the trumpet blows. Vision 2. It was in the middle of downtown Los Angeles, California. Holy Spirit taught me that on Wilshire Boulevard, a young man and woman were walking in the sidewalk along the street. They were heading west with the man walking to the bush side and the woman walking to the street side. The man was making an impassioned speech to the woman, criticizing Jesus. Being lost in his rational criticism, he called the Bible irrational and made comments to ignore Christianity. The woman was walking carefully and praying inside without any response to his remarks, with her head down a little bit and a book held to her chest. "Have mercy on him, Lord." In the middle of her prayer, she suddenly heard the loud trumpet sound from the sky.
"Rise up here."
She looked up in the sky with her face full of joy and excitement. She had no time to express her joy because she was raised up in the air the moment she looked up. He suddenly found her gone and looked around in bewilderment to find her when there was a clash in the street. The downtown street was traffic jammed, which means the car accident was a fender bender instead of a huge one. God granted me spiritual knowledge as if I were watching the scene and taught me that the trumpet sound are only heard by those who get raptured. With much traffic in the area, cars were moving slowly. There would not be many people who were ascending in the air in those circumstances, which gives some idea about how much spiritually corrupted cities are. I was looking down at the scene high up in the air and asked Jesus, "What will the world say about people being raised up in the air, Jesus?" He gave me accurate and detailed answers.
NASA of the United States will make an announcement that thousands of UFO from a distant planet in the universe surrounded the entire Earth and abducted numerous people around the world with a powerful ultra-modern sucking machine in one moment, promising to make further investigations into the matter and trying to cover it up.
A building that looked like a county official building woke up to the emergency sirens ringing through the building. People were perplexed in this situation that Jesus mentioned before. That is, people were abducted, and those who were left behind were talking about it in surprise. A young single lady came out of the building in a hurry and arrived at her home. Going into the house, she yelled, "Mom!" She was looking around the house to find her mom, suddenly stopping at a point to realize what happened. A devout Christian, her mom always reasoned with her, who ignored her persuasion and regarded her stories about the end of the world as a joke. Then she had a realization. It was not an abduction case by aliens from a distant planet, but the rapture. Her mom was raised into heaven, and she was left in the world to face the tribulation. Realizing all of those, she plunked herself down and wept bitterly in such great pain. Vision 4. I saw those who were left behind in the world. They had increasingly difficult time to make a living because they had no mark on the forehead. They sold their houses and decided to move to another place. A group of people that looked like a family were carrying heavy luggage and bags and reached a pier in hopes of getting aboard and moving to another country. They could not live in the city because they had no mark. When trying to get aboard at the pier, they finally realized that no mark meant no getting aboard as well. Being rejected out of the ship, they turned around with lowered shoulders and walked with no strength. They could not get in a car and had to walk to a mountain. Another group of people were walking along the railway in a row. They were carrying many bags and luggage on their shoulders and in their hands and taking heavy and difficult steps. It was apparent that they had walked a huge distance. At that moment, a state-of-the-art train was passing by. The entire windows looked like glass tubes through which people along the railway could look inside. In the train, the children of demon, people with a mark on their forehead or hand, were drinking canned beer, eating something delicious and making noises. Spotting people outside the windows, they pointed at them, made fun of them, and laughed loud with one another. Some would dart their tongues in and out and make provoking gestures right up against the window. Looking at them, the people in the street made reactions. Some would burst into cries in distress, and others would get mad, curse at them, and swing their fists at them. Then, a man came up to those who were crying, held them around the shoulders and patted them in the back, consoled them, and carried their luggage for them. He moved to those who got mad, invited them to stop what they were doing, and calm them down. He was a minister left by God in a mission of serving those who were left in the Great Tribulation. His actions were full of love. God made me realize that the first requirement for a minister for the left in the world is love. They were also heading to a mountain. The children of God with no marks had no choice but to go to a mountain since there were no jobs for them in the city. They had to escape into a mountain in order to depend on plants for living and avoid the persecution of Antichrist and his group.
Jesus is coming quickly in the clouds. First time taken, December 7, 2006. King David. It was the time during early morning prayer. Suddenly, my body felt hot and had desire to lie down. After I lied down, I started to see a view before my eyes. At first, I did not know where I was. But soon after, I knew I was looking at the throne of God. In the huge temple, from afar there was one person. There was the throne of God left of him. The person who were standing was Jesus. I knew for sure that the Father God sat on the throne. I could only recognize the outline of Jesus' face. He looked slimmer. I thought, oh, this is probably what Stephen saw.
But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Acts 7:55-56.
At that moment, Jesus slowly came and stood on the right side of me. And he touched my head. I became a little child and stood there quietly. After that, Jesus held my hand and led me somewhere. On both sides of the road, the flowers were blossoming beautifully and the road was golden color. I felt overwhelmed and was full of joy and happiness in my heart. And I realized that I should not waste any time and see everything that I need to see. I quickly asked Jesus, "Jesus, do I have a house here? If I do, can you show it to me?" For some reason, I felt he was hesitant to show it to me. In heaven you can read people's mind without speaking. I became aware that it is the power of Almighty God, who dominated everything. Few moments later, I asked him again, "Please show me my house." I was begging like a little child. Eventually Jesus led me the way to show me. At the end of the road there was a small one-story house. As a whole, it was golden color without shining. There was a small door and one big window that seemed to be the entire house. I entered the house and it was shabby scenery in front of me. It was one room studio with furniture scattered around. There was no curtain in the window, making it very empty and eerie atmosphere. I was so embarrassed that I begged to see my house in this condition. I put my head down as I couldn't hide. As Jesus was looking at me, I could feel his heart communicating to me.
"This is why I did not want to show it to you,"
he began to comfort me.
"You can build your rewards from now on. You can do it. I will help you."
Then, Jesus raised his hand and took his heart from his left chest. It was something you have never seen in the world, a bright red heart. Jesus' heart was the love itself. Even though I described it as bright red color, the color was so beautiful, nothing to compare in the earthly color. Jesus took that beautiful red heart and put it in my heart. At that moment, I started sobbing. At that time, there was a beautiful tenor voice singing the praise song. Opening my eyes and looking around, I saw a golden carriage. It was carried by two horses. In the carriage, there was a handsome man who is similar character in the movie, Ben-Hur. The outfit was same as the character from the movie. He wore a lined skirt with string shoes up to his knees. Only thing different was the crown on his head. He was short with a cute face and held a halter in one hand and was praising with his left hand raised up. As soon as I asked myself who this person was, Jesus answered my question.
"It's David."
"Oh, King David. I actually saw the King David from the Bible. I was sent to the earth without having the time to be happy. And I felt my physical body. But I couldn't bring myself up, and instead of laying there for a moment, I could not believe what I actually experienced. Moments later, I got up and drove back home. While driving I kept on sobbing. Even after parking my car, I sat in the car sobbing for a long time. It was Jesus' tears. Later I realized that it was the tear of love from Jesus who shed blood for me. He gave me his heart to shed tears for other souls. His heart was to help me to build a beautiful house from a shabby one. With his tears from heart of love, I've been saved. He spoke to me today, "I have saved you with my tears, so you tear for my people to save them." January 25, 2007. Mom, first time I saw the hell. I went to church for an early morning prayer. It was a spiritual mood that something would happen. After having a series of spiritual experiences recently, I braced myself for devoting myself completely to Lord. I heard Lord say that I should go home and lie there. I jumped in my car and drove home, where my mouth started to speak in tongues without my awareness. I strongly felt that God would show me the hell today. Finally, Jesus came to me and said,
"My daughter, I love you. I love you."
"Lord, I love you, too," I answered him with love. I was walking beside Jesus and looked like a virgin. Jesus spans me around, holding both of my hands. Playing with me with a smile upon his face, he said,
I have something to show you today. Come with me. My daughter, do not be afraid.
Jesus opened up his arms, welcomed me, and held me in his arms by bending over. I knew he said inside, come on in. It is good that you've come. He let me know that people need the childlike faith to go to heaven. I was happy in his arms when I heard praise song somewhere. This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings, and round me rings the music of the spheres. An exclamation came out my mouth without my knowledge. Words cannot describe the landscape before me. I saw the flowing streams, wildflowers, beautiful flowers along the shining golden road, and a shallow hill all in splendid colors, and became extremely happy. There were picturesque castle towns like in Disneyland over the distant hill. They were beautifully decorated with shining jewels. It was third heaven. Wow! I kept on speaking out exclamations about the indescribably beautiful castle towns. I wanted to go in there, but Jesus said it was not allowed to go in this time. Then I saw Mom standing next to him and smiling at me. Ah, Mom. She was such a beautiful lady and looked more beautiful than ever. She was in light pink Korean traditional dress called hanbok, beaming with youth and beauty. People I met in heaven, including David, Peter, and Paul, all wore various kinds of clothes. I realized that people in heaven wore clothes according to their tastes. My mom always loved hanbok and looked good in it, which explains why she wore hanbok even in heaven. Unlike the bibliographical figures I met, she said nothing and was just smiling. Jesus later gave me an explanation about it. My feelings for her were not human love like before, but love between saints. I just loved those feelings. I was walking in the golden road with my hands held by Jesus and Mom each. Trotting down the road with them, I was very cheerful and happy to turn my hands held by them. We came upon a pond. We sat on a rock by the pond with me in the middle between them. Wearing a smile upon his face, Jesus asked me,
"Are you happy?"
"Yes, I am." I was having fun when he took a mouthful of water and put it into my mouth, saying,
"Drink this water. It is very sweet."
It was very sweet, indeed. I felt my body moving and turning soft in the world. Like Jesus, Mom too took a mouthful of water and put it into my mouth. Drinking it, I felt like I'm already excited and I feel fling away. I soon realized that I was floating over heaven actually. People often say I feel like I am flying when they are extremely happy. In heaven, they can actually fly when they feel like so. After taking a flight around the sky by myself and looking down the castle towns and plains, I returned back to my place. Jesus then took me somewhere to show me some other places. Mom was not there. She must have returned back to her place. But I did not bother to go out and look for her. I came into some door with Jesus. It was a huge hall. I later found out it was a big white sanctuary building. The interior was gorgeously decorated with jewels. I was so surprised and kept looking around. We were guided to a big room on the right. A beautiful boy-like girly-haired angel in a white gown welcomed me with a smile. There were rows of beautiful dresses hung on the long, wide wall behind him and beautiful and fabulous gowns on the shelves. The angel brought me a pink dress. Once I put on the dress, I strangely looked fit, slender, and beautiful in it. He brought me a crown, too. Wearing it, I felt extreme happiness. Jesus too changed his clothes and wore a crown, looking like a king. He asked again,
"Are you happy?"
"Yes, I am. Very happy," I answered. In fact, I was so happy that I smiled a big smile without knowing. We returned back to the entry. A group of beautiful people in beautiful clothes and crowns was found in the right corner of the room. Jesus came up the stairs at the center and sat in the throne. The people worshiped Jesus. We worshiped the Lamb of God. We bowed down to Jesus. Jesus blessed us, raising both hands and saying,
"I bless you all."
We all said to him, "Amen." Jesus came out of the room and took me to the pond again, where he told me about it.
"It is a special pond. When you drink this water, you will live forever. When you wash by this water, Your sins will be erased.
We were leaving the place, and I felt we were coming out of the gate of heaven. Both Jesus and I had the clothes changed. He was in a casual robe without crown, and I was in a casual dress too. We walked for a while and came to the place of agonizing cries. It was the hell. He made me realize that the hell was not distant from the heaven because the spiritual world itself transcended time and space. When Abraham was holding Lazarus and talking with a rich man in hell, there was a huge pit. I felt about the same distance as it. Entering the hell, I saw a small prison before me. There was one of my relatives who died without believing in Jesus. He was reaching out his hands towards me and begging me desperately. Maggots were crawling in his body and eating a part of his face in the left side. Despite all of those, I intuitively knew that he was my relative. Get me out of here. I had nothing that I could do for him. I have no power. I am sorry. I answered sadly. Even though we were connected with blood, I could not save him whose life had been ended. We should do everything we can do to help other souls to be saved when they are still alive. Once they stop breathing, there is nothing you can do for them. What kind of people are coming to the hell, Jesus?
It is those who don't believe in me, betray me, or don't love me. I do not want even a single person to be thrown into hell. I truly and sincerely hope no hell for all souls. Go and tell people that I don't want any people to come to hell.
He was so sad that he dropped his head on one side and moaned. I could see a pit of fire below the place where I was talking to me. There were people holding out hands and bawling out in it. Save us out of here, Lord. There were screaming because there were so much heat. Words are not enough to describe their pain and desperation. My soul started to cry out loud. There was a long row of small prisons just like one I saw before over the pit. It was filled by people, who were only skeletons and holding out bony arms through the iron bars. I was crying and so surprised to see that. What kind of people are thrown into those prisons? I asked Jesus.
It is my servants that betrayed me. I gave them the royal gift to spread Lord's words, but they took my glory as theirs glory and their greed.
I then started to cry again. My crying became louder and louder until it turned into wailing. I could bear the pain. It was the pain of Jesus. He let me feel his pain. I was tired of crying and sat down, crying more by holding his clothes. He patted me on my head and said in a sorrowful tone with tears in his eyes,
"Don't cry, my daughter."
He kept patting on my head. He took me, who was crying endlessly, to another place. It was back in heaven. It was strange enough that my pain gradually disappeared in heaven and was soon forgotten. We went into the white sanctuary, where all the saints were there. Jesus came up the stairs and stood on the right of the throne of Father God. When the Father God came in, my body was completely lying down on the floor. My nose was touching the floor, and my arms were reaching out upwards. The people who gathered there started to praise Lord and showed their respect in a humble fashion before him. The sanctuary where the Holy Father was sitting in the throne became full of indescribable respect. The respect was based on deep love for God rather than fear. The Father God said in a resounding voice,
"I want my people to be saved so quickly. Who will take the mission for us?"
The people in lines all turned to me as well as Jesus, who held out his arm and pointed at me, saying,
"I believe she is the right person."
I was taken by such huge surprise and about to say I could not do it because I could not. However, completely different words came out of my mouth. I cannot do it, but I will be able to do it with the power by Jesus. After listening to my confession, God gave me a golden plaque with a short baton hanging down from it. Later, the baton became invisible with only the golden plaque viewed with a naked eye. It was shining so bright like a lump of gold. It had two vertical grooves and gold tassels at the end. It was 5 centimeters wide and 7 centimeters long. Father God said,
"I give you this, and the power of evil will not harm you. You will face hardship, but it will help you overcome."
I felt huge trembles inside me when he gave it to me. I held it in my hand and raised it high. Then angels started to fly and sing praising the Lord. Jesus was happy. He took me and said,
"Let's go, you're in my home."
He said, "You're in my home instead of my home." I was happy about the idea of home of Jesus and me. I was joyful after I saw my home in heaven, which became bigger and more beautiful. I was amazed seeing my house, which had been changed for the a couple of days. There was a little stream running in front of the house. The green grass field was so beautiful. I spotted trees I did not before. What was more surprising was that second floor was under construction. Seeing that I could not shut my mouth, Jesus said,
"Your obedience has been accelerating the construction."
The interior was decorated even more splendidly. The one spare walls were decorated with jewels. The one empty floor was furnished with a red carpet. The couches were replaced with more splendid ones. A chandelier was hanging from the ceiling. I ran to the gorgeous bed and jumped on it. I was so happy that I was rolling in the bed. Jesus came to me and lied beside me with a smile upon his face.
"Are you happy?"
Jesus continued said.
"Just like I am here with you now, I am with all people in their homes simultaneously. But they don't seem to know it. I am happy that you know it."
He raised me up and took me to the sofa. He sat in the three-person sofa and I in the two-person sofa. There was a basket full of fruits on the table. He picked a fruit like green grape and put it into my mouth. I returned the same favor to him. He was happy to receive one and enjoy it. I also gave him a fruit like pomegranate and saw him enjoy it, too. Jesus and I were enjoying fruits and smiling at each other. Coming out of the house, we played around happily and laughed loud. Playing hide and seek, I would find him and clap a lot to find him. In heaven, I would feel happy and clap often. Even in the world, I would raise my hands high and clap for appreciation and praise when I am happy or grateful. When we turn glory to God in the world, He is very happy. I often experience anointing in my hands that turn glory to God. We were playing so happily, when I suddenly turned my head and saw a group of people in line going somewhere. Where are they going?
They are going for worship service.
Jesus answered me and took me there. People were going into the white sanctuary. Two angels were standing at both sides of the gate like guards and welcomed them with a smile. I went into the building, took a seat in the second floor, and looked down thanks to Jesus who prepared the seat. People were standing toward the throne, packed inside the building. Soon they started to worship God. The saints of heaven participated in true and spirit worship. Watching the beautiful and magnificent scene, I took a deep breath and found myself back this body. A visit by Jesus. At night on January 25, 2007. About the end time. Jesus came to me and sat at my bedside.
"I want to talk with you like this today."
I naturally realized it was about the end time. "Is it about the end?" I asked him.
"Yes. I am going to talk about the end time with you."
In December 2006, Jesus showed me rapture in a vision. When I was praying, I suddenly saw a blue sky. Then I saw people down on the land in small silhouette. Suddenly clouds started to rise up here and there simultaneously. At first, I was bewildered at the sight and soon realized its rapture. I looked at the scene in surprise, joy, and deep emotion. God told me to write down something after the scene.
_ There will be huge famines and earthquakes before the Great Tribulation. The heaven and earth will become dark. Those who were looking for me will betray me. Men will pursue men, and women will pursue women to an extreme degree. Stay awake and keep praying. Listen to my words and practice them. Most of all, practice love. Love will overcome everything. Satan will be defeated by love. The servants who are awake and pray when I come will know when I will come and make preparations in advance. I will gather them in a place. Try to gather and pray. Those who stand alone will fall down. Fear me and make effort to pray. I will help you. I will help you by granting you great power and faith that are not like before. I will lift up my people without much tribulation. _
Jesus also showed me another scene. I saw a soldier in a military cap on my right side. I thought he was a Chinese soldier. He was in war. I saw another scene on my left side. The army was in formation and shot cannons. They felt like missiles. The both sides were in a fierce confrontation. God recently told me something about China. He said China was being used for mission for Israel and also used by the tool of Satan. In other words, the Chinese Christians will engage in the mission for Israel, while the Chinese government will be in a political confrontation with Israel. After watching the scene, Jesus told me,
there will be an alliance formed between China and Arab Emirates at the end, which is just right before rapture. They will fight in war against Israel. That is a sign of the end.
Shameful salvation, the fruit of good and evil, and warnings against heresy. I was praying at home in the morning and soon found Jesus beside me. It was 4 days since I met him last time. I was longing for him badly for days, as if I were suffering from love sickness. I was so happy and moved to see him again and held him tight in the waist. Lord, I missed you so much.
I know. That's why I came back.
He said,
come on, let's go. I have something to show you.
He urged me and took me to heaven. We went into a huge room on the right through a big white gate. I changed clothes and wore a crown. I chose a white robe that day. Jesus wore a beautiful and shining robe and crown. We went into the huge temple. Jesus put me over there and he sat on the throne. There were many saints in that temple with crowns on the head. They started to sing praise Jesus with clapping hands. The moment their praise was over, I started to dance and praise happily. I raised my arms high in a V shape and went around in a circle with one leg lifted. They were also clapping happily. I saw Jesus was happy, too. He was pleased and found beauty in the ways we praised and danced with all heart and spirit, regardless of how loud our voices were or how good our dances were. Jesus came down and took me outside. We held each other's hands and walked along the golden road. At the shallow hill at the end of the road, Jesus sat down and said,
that is what I wanted to show you.
I looked down to the right side of the hill, sitting by him. There were rows of shabby little houses, unlike other houses in heaven. They were like townhouses in a block scheduled for redevelopment. It was not bright and not dark. I found it very strange. It was such an opposite scene to all those bright, splendid, and beautiful places I saw in heaven. Jesus said,
that is where your mom lived.
What? My mom lived there? It was not like my home I saw. Seeing me in a shock, he said,
yes. She accepted me just before she died, which is why she lives there. People living in that place have limitations with their actions. They don't get to enjoy all the beautiful things in heaven forever. They also have to lower themselves and stay humble forever because they feel shameful by themselves.
Jesus wants all of us to enjoy everything in heaven. He wants all of us to praise Lord to the fullest and live in a bright and beautiful place forever. He feels sorry for those who cannot. That is why he shows me the place today. I could feel his heart. Can I visit the place?
You can go anywhere you want to. You can visit your mom's, but she can't get in New Jerusalem where your home is. Since you have your body now, you will feel sorry for her. But once you enter heaven, you will no longer feel sorry for her. In heaven, you will maintain a saint's relationship with her, which is more beautiful than a mother-daughter relationship, forever.
There is no one to limit or restrict her in heaven. It is just that she is ashamed of herself and will not go to a place where it is bright. As people often say, those who get to heaven by the shameful salvation, they will figure out everything and become very ashamed. Being ashamed that they ignored Jesus and feeling sorry for it, they will restrict their words and actions and limit the scope of their action themselves. It was the case with my mom, who received Jesus right before her death. That is why she only smiled without saying a word when I first saw her with Jesus. He called her there so that I could meet her. It was not her will. That is why she disappeared so quickly. Jesus was about to get up.
There is no time to waste. Let's visit another place.
Wait, Jesus. I love talking with you here.
Let's talk more at your house. It has got a new swing.
I loved swings and was happy to hear that. The second floor of the house was near completion. I opened up my mouth without knowing. He took me here because he knew I would be happy to see it.
I am happy to see you obey me. I am happy to see that your house construction going fast because of your obedience.
Being happy, I went inside and found a bookshelf containing only a couple of books, including the Bible. He said to me, looking at it,
I knew you loved books and brought one here.
I expressed my gratitude and joy with my hands folded like when in prayer. He then delivered even happier news.
Whenever a person reads this book and has his or her soul saved, I will allow you have additional book.
Finding happiness in giving rewards, he knew that I loved many books and made a kind arrangement to give me more rewards. There was a two-person swing in front of the house. I sat on the house side, and Jesus on the stream side. Our conversation resumed about the end. The Bible says that we should be awake and pray since the end of everything is near. What does being awake mean exactly?
It means devoting oneself to God's words and prayers. Those who love me will find me through prayers. Those who want to listen to my voice will do so by reading my words. I will meet those who love me. They will listen to my voice who wants to hear my voice.
Someone asked me how those who received the Holy Spirit could be thrown into hell. He said he learned that those who received the Holy Spirit once would have nothing to do with hell forever.
That is why I keep saying that you should be awake. Being awake requires balanced faith. Devotion only to prayers will lead to spiritual arrogancy. Devotion only to God's words will lead to intellectual arrogancy. It will be desirable to balance between them in terms of faith. Especially intellectual arrogancy can easily result in heresy. Good examples include Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons. You get to fall in heresy while trying to unfold the words of Bible forcefully.
Swinging back and forth in the swing, I turned to him and asked, reading the Bible, I have always wondered why God put people in suffering by creating tree of life and fruit of good and evil. It would have been better if he had not created them in the first place. Jesus said,
tree of life and fruit of good and evil are the lines to tell divine nature from human nature. God created them and ordered people to eat only the fruits of tree of life. That is what God intended by creating men and making them his children. God wanted them to eat the fruits of tree of life and live with him forever like him. While those who eat the fruits of tree of life will become filled with divine nature, become children of God and live in eternal life, those who eat the fruits of good and evil will become filled with human nature, become children of man, criticize others, sit in the seat of God, and be hated and cursed by God. God created both good and evil because he is fair. He always places good with evil to make good even better. That is the reason for coexistence. Man has free will and always make a choice between good and evil. God granted character to men and wanted them to choose good for themselves. However, they listened to Satan's voice, chose evil, and got cursed. Listen well, the fruits of tree of life and those of good and evil are always present in human life as well as in Eden. Those who are full of divine nature will be guided by Holy Spirit and choose the fruits of tree of life instead of those of good and evil when the situation comes, thus owning heaven in their life. On the other hand, those who are full of human nature will be attracted to evil spirit like magnet, eat the fruits of good and evil, bear the fruit of flesh and life, and commit spiritual adultery with Satan. Even those who are received the Holy Spirit can listen to Satan's voice, get tempted by him, and get cursed as long as they have the flesh. That is why I ask you to receive Holy Spirit fully. I do not want anybody to get tempted by Satan, commit spiritual adultery with him, and desert me. Satan knows well why God created both the fruits of tree of life and those of good and evil, thus constantly tempting the children of God to eat the fruits of good and evil, and to commit sins, which prevent them from getting an eternal life, and eventually face death.
Then he got up from the swing and led me without saying a word. I followed him without saying a word. We arrived at hell and saw people in the fire pit screaming. Having witnessed their pain several times, I no longer felt the scene was unfamiliar and shed tears. Only sorrow gathered at a corner of my heart. It was a state of my mind that I formed after Jesus gave me comfort and boldness through breathing when I was afraid in hell. Passing the fire hell, we went to the prison where Judas Iscariot was. There he showed me a person, who was holding out his bony arms through the iron bars and desperately asking for salvation.
He belonged to heresy. Like Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons, those who distort and interpret God's words or add or subtract something to them will fall in heresy due to their intellectual arrogance.
Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. 2 Peter 1:20. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do the other Scriptures, to their own destruction. 2 Peter 3:16.
In the early morning of February 3, 2007, Jesus and I were walking slowly and sat down to start up a conversation at a place. Our talks were mostly about books.
I will write this book by borrowing your hand. I am the writer, designer, editor, and marketer. I will make all of my children all over the world read the book through you.
His words once again confirmed that I was merely a writer. Lord, I suspect that some will repute the book with theological grounds. But some parts have no grounds in the Bible. He answered in a serious tone.
I am God. Theology is a science to know God and accumulate knowledge about God. The order should be getting to know about God first and then accumulating knowledge about God. Those people, however, will first analyze me before getting to know me, and develop intellectual arrogance. I want my servants whom I love to invest more time in getting to know me and heaven. He also added, those who listen to me and believe me are blessed. Those who listen to me and do not believe in me are more evil than those who do not listen to me.
After having those conversations for a while, he stood up.
Now, go to sleep. You must be tired.
Lord, a lot of people are waiting for me to return from a visit to heaven. I had better visit heaven today and see lots of things to describe to them. Please bring me heaven today. I urged him by holding his clothes. He looked at me and smiled. Then he pinched me in the cheek as if I were so cute.
You have greed for faith, and it makes me happy. It is your greed that I use you. The heaven is up for those who conquer.
Those who are criticizing God's words. Suddenly I saw flames before me. They were burning up right in front of my eyes. I saw people screaming in pain in the flames. It was like a close-up version of the fire hell I saw before. Then another scene came up. I was not sure whether it was a fire pit or prison. I was able to make only a person out. At the moment, I heard the voice of Jesus, but he was not there to be found.
He listened to my words, but he chose not to believe it and just criticized it.
Endless rows of small snakes that were as thick as a finger were coming out of his eyes, nose, ears, mouth, and other part of his body. He kept screaming in pain with his mouth open wide. I lowered my head because it was too painful to watch him suffer from small snakes. Then I urged him again, saying I don't want to see any more. It is too painful. Please take me to heaven right now. To think of heaven, I got curious about my house. Jesus then took me back to heaven in front of the house. The second floor has been completed. Everything was fine as they were, including the streams before the house, the green grass field, and the swing. There was a white rabbit jumping across the field. It suddenly stopped and stared at me. Mdachi must be the owner of the house. With a facial expression that it figured it out, the rabbit jumped away. Jesus would always be cheerful and humorous at the house, even though he would not be that way usually. Then I realized what he was thinking. He made me realize it that day after several visits before. Jesus said rewards are to be accumulated with your heart rather than time. He must be pleased with the rewards of heaven that were being accumulated by my heart. Then who gave me that heart? It was the Lord. Blessing of sharing. One of my friends visited me with her husband, Deacon L. We started to pray. I felt the fullness of the Holy Spirit. After a powerful shock went through my body, I was taken to heaven and met Jesus. I told Jesus, Lord, Deacon L said he wished to visit heaven. He laughed and said people had different missions. I laughed too, along with my body in the world. Jesus was pleased the fact that Deacon L had yearning for heaven. Jesus said something about the wife of Deacon L.
Tell her to pray. If she prays, I will give her more faith. If she loves, I will give her more love.
Jesus took me back to heaven. The first person I saw was Abraham. It was the third time I saw him. I was happy to see him and shouted loud, "Grandpa Abraham!" I called him Grandpa without even realizing it. Jesus let me know that all called him Grandpa in heaven, unlike in the world where he was called Abraham. It was because he was the ancestor of faith. Grandpa Abraham kindly welcomed me. He led me into the big sanctuary. I went into a big room and wore a pink dress and crown. Jesus was already in a shining robe and splendid crown. I went into the sanctuary in a different way from before. Jesus walked to the throne, holding my hand. There were beautiful people on the right with beautiful robes and crowns. They bent over and bowed to Jesus. He sat in the throne, and I was standing alone close to the throne. When he first took me to heaven, I was standing close to the gate of the sanctuary. When I was dancing last time, I was standing at the center. On that day, I was standing very close to the throne. Jesus filled my spirit with knowledge of God and made my body increasingly closer to God as my knowledge grew. It was the same with a church in the world. The more grace I received, the more I want to sit closer to pulpit. People started to praise Lord in one voice. Praise the Lamb of God forever and more. After my dance and praise were over, he came down from the platform and took me to the reward house. The moment I felt like looking at the second floor, I was on the second floor. I recalled the event of resurrected Jesus meeting his disciples that were hiding after locking the door. There is time and space transcendence in heaven. The second floor looked like a break room. There were a long couch where I could sit down and read a book and exercise equipments for light workout. Jesus was looking down, standing beside me on the second floor. I too looked down to see myself and the deacon couples on the earth with surprise. It was in my living room. They were in the middle of prayer with me who was lying beside them. It was like looking at miniatures. It was very strange and curious. I was moved to ask Jesus about Deacon L. How do you want Deacon L to pray?
Tell him to pray for youth group.
It was at that moment when the male deacon was praying in tongues and Jesus started to laugh, with being pleased. I was laughing, too. I laughed for a while without knowing why. After I woke up, I asked Deacon L, "You were praying, and Jesus was pleased and laughed. What were you praying for?"
"I was praying for the youth group because there would be an event in a couple of days,"
he told me. I suddenly started to laugh hard. Lord was so pleased because Deacon L prayed what Jesus asked for. Jesus wanted to know that praying what God wants to pray makes God very pleased. Looking down at the praying deacon couples in heaven, I asked Jesus, "Lord, I hope you will anoint them." Jesus ordered the angel to anoint them. The angels were holding a round green jar-like bottle. They anointed us three down there. Deacon couples prayed passionately after anointing from angels. Intercessory prayer generates several effects. God wants to bless more of His children. When I say an intercessory prayer for someone's health, I will get healthy too. When I say a prayer for someone's soul, my soul will be blessed too. And when I say a prayer for someone's financial blessing, I will also be blessed financially. Heaven with going through faith. Jesus came to me and talked to me. I welcomed him with a bright smile. Even though he did not say he loved him out loud, I was able to feel his soft love. It was like trust between a couple in a long marriage. He said,
"You go to heaven through faith."
I made a confession of faith to him. "Lord, I believe in you as my Savior and I also believe there is heaven." At that moment, I was standing in front of the gate of heaven as a child. Jesus welcomed me and held me in his arms, waiting for me with an angel at each side. I ran up to him and was held in his arms tight like a child. He bent over and held me tight. Patting me in the back, he said,
"Welcome. You've come here through your faith."
It should be me to thank him since I got to heaven due to the faith he granted me. Being curious, I asked, "Aren't you taking me somewhere today, Jesus?"
"You can go anywhere in heaven through faith. Now, go."
sacrifice on the cross. Jesus said,
I will show you some place.
I readily knew that it was hell but did not hesitate like before. Lord, I now know the hardship you suffered and the pain you endured. I will accompany you wherever that is. When I knelt down before him on one knee, he showed me his feet with the nail wounds. His feet with the nail wound were shining white. The holes were white. I bent over at his feet, kissed them, and cried to think of his sacrifice for me. It was not tears of sorrow to be concerned with him but tears of thanks. He first drained my mind and then showed me his feet. He raised me who was crying up. I saw the people in the fire pit before again, but the number increased much further. The pit was jam-packed. I was a little bit surprised to the increased number in such a short time, but I did not reveal my surprise. Their screams seemed to grow louder. Jesus said in a very sad with weeping voice,
My sacrifice on the cross was in vain. So many people betrayed me and are here.
At his words, my heart sank heavily. The devils were poking them in line deep with a sharp spear endlessly. They were trying to move around to avoid their spear attacks. But there were so many people in the pit, there was no room for moving around. They had to stand there and scream in such pain with their mouths open wide. There was another group of people who were naked and lying down. The devils were hitting them in the back with a whip. They were all bones, as well. The devils were using a whip with hooks hanging at the tip like the one they used to use to hurt Jesus in Roman period. Every time the whip hit them in the back, several red lines broke out with flesh torn away. They were not able to sit up, merely screaming horribly lying down. The whip attacks continued on. The scene was so tragic that I burst into tears. Jesus in a very sad tone said,
They once again nailed me on a cross. You go out and tell them not to nail me on the cross.
It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the coming agent who have fallen away, to be brought back to repentance. To their loss they are crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting him to public disgrace. Hebrews 6:4-6.
The people I met in heaven. Under the guidance of God, I stayed at the home of Sister L in New York for a week at the end of November, 2007. Sister L received Jesus only a while ago. We were sitting down at the table and talked about heaven and hell, when she started to talk about her parents who were passed away.
You said those who died not believing in Jesus would go to hell, right? My father did not believe in him. He must be in hell. I heard my mother believe it in him right before she died. I was in the United States and could not be with her at the last moment of her life. So, I can't be sure. Do you think my father will be transferred to heaven if I pray hard?
Even though it hurt me, I had to tell her the truth. Once your breath stops, there is nothing more to be done. That is why it is important to repent when living. It is the only way you go to heaven. Once you are thrown into hell, there is no other way. It is clear with the metaphor of the rich man and Lazarus in the Bible. I could not help watching her who was feeling sorry for her late father without saying a word, when I felt that Lord was taking me to heaven suddenly. I was bewildered because I was not in the middle of prayer, but God had done it often before. Following the mind of obedience he gave me, I said to the sister, Lord is about to take me to heaven. Pray to God. She started to pray. I was taken to heaven after some prayers. Jesus took me and introduced me to some people. A man and woman were standing on the golden road, holding each other's hands and looking at me. I was curious about them, who were looking at me with a smile upon their faces and holding each other's hands affectionately. Jesus said,
They are Sister L's parents.
The man who were smiling and saying no words was her father. I was able to communicate with my mom inside, but there was no way for me to read his thoughts. He was saying nothings inside him. I was very surprised and curious, asking Jesus, how can he be in heaven even though he didn't believe in you?
When he was in a state of coma, I met him, made him believe in me, and brought him here.
Oh, I see. Jesus once told me that he never misses his children. Jesus must have visited Del's father at the last moment, preached the gospel to him, and brought him to heaven. The man received Lord even later than my mom, and he would not dare to say a word. I then realized that Lord listened to my prayer, visited my mom who had been in a state of coma for long, gave her faith, and brought her to heaven. The mother of Sister L, who was holding hands with her husband, had her hair pulled up in hanbok. Unlike her husband who could not say a word even spiritually, she was able to speak spiritually even though it was not through her mouth. She asked me to deliver some messages to her daughter in the world. Both of them seemed so happy that I felt happy, too. Then Lord brought me back to the world. Upon waking up, I asked Sister L, "Sister, was your father in a state of coma?"
"Yes. I heard he passed away after being in a state of coma at the hospital."
"And did your mother love to wear hanbok with her hair pulled up?"
"Yes."
She was surprised and started to weep. After checking out a few things, I talked about her parents that God introduced me to. She was so surprised and happy that she burst into tears. I was also so grateful for God's great love and cried while holding her in my arms. It was the most rewarding moment. How grateful I was. God gave me another realization through this visit. No one can be certain about whether some person is in heaven or not. Someone that you think he might not be in heaven might be in heaven. Other people that you are sure to see in heaven might not be in heaven. No one can guarantee themselves that they will go to heaven because it is solely up to God's sovereignty. We should therefore be humble before Lord instead of being arrogant. We must constantly pray that He will give us unchanged faith until we stand before Him. We should not be careless and conceited.
Many will say to me on that day, "Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in Your name and in Your name drive out demons and in Your name perform many miracles?" Then I will tell them plainly, "I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers." Matthew 7:22-23. Not everyone who says to me, "Lord, Lord," will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Matthew 7:21.
Roman Catholicism 1. Jesus, where is Mary? I was thinking of saying Holy Mother Mary like people usually did in the world, but Mary came out of my mouth. It was God's intention that Mary was not Holy Mother but a human being, and that she could not be the object of worship.
She is taking care of children there.
I was moved to the place. I was soon standing in front of a school building. The white square building contained many children in different rooms. A couple of women were standing in front of the door. When I saw the lady who was holding a baby in the left, I knew it was Mary. She had an elegant, slender, and beautiful face. I raised my hands and said hallelujah to her without even realizing it. She answered back hallelujah, looking at me with a smile upon her face. Then she bent her knees and showed her respect to Jesus. He explained,
"She is taking care of aborted children along with the women she used to live together in the world."
I asked Mary, "Mary, people pray to you. What do you think about this way of praying?" I never thought of such a question. It was God that led me to such a question. He wanted to have her answer the question by making me ask it to her. She had a perplexed facial expression as if she were sorry to Jesus.
"I am always sorry to Lord because of it. They have got it wrong. They will know the truth if they go to heaven."
If they go to heaven. It means that no all believers of Roman Catholicism will get into the kingdom of heaven according to Lord. Only those who belong to Lord will go to heaven. I then realized why Lord made me see a king from Old Testament and my mom before I saw Mary. The king from Old Testament served an idol while saying he served God and was thrown into hell. Mary is another idol, and serving her while saying they served God will make a sin. That is, Lord warns that if we serve another human being, we will go to hell instead of heaven. There is no need to pray to Mary or say Ave Maria. As soon as Mary finished her words, Jesus put his hand on her head. I placed the other hand of Jesus on my head without even realizing it and said to him with kneeling down, "Bless me, too." Jesus placed his hand on my head and said with being pleased,
"Your greed makes me happy. You shall be double blessed.
My heart was filled with huge happiness at the moment. There is no title called Holy Mother in heaven. Mary is another person at the same level as us rather than Holy Mother or the object of worship. It was at that moment that I saw Mother Teresa behind Mary with whom I was walking. I remember her very wrinkly face in this world, but she had such a fair, wrinkle-free face in heaven. She was wearing a beautiful crown. She was helping a baby to walk with her waist bent down. She was saying to me,
I used to ask a favor to Mary because I didn't know better. Once I got to heaven, I realized I did wrong.
Looking at the children, I got curious, Lord, how long will they be brought up here? Do they grow up in heaven, too? Mary answered,
Children grow up to be 33 in heaven, which was the age of Jesus when he was crucified. After that, they will go to places of their choice.
I do not know why, but suddenly I was thinking about Mr. Meng. Recalling his short hairstyle, I asked another question, How do they trim their hair in heaven? Do they have a barber shop, too? Everyone there burst into laughter, including Jesus, who found me asking that question very lovely. He treated me favorably. Looking at me with love in his eyes, Jesus said,
There is a barber shop in heaven, too. But it was designed to give comfort for the people who just die and comes to heaven. Once you get into heaven, there is no need for cutting your hair or using hair salon service. It was an act of God's kindness to help people get accustomed to heaven.
Roman Catholicism 2. When I prayed to God, I felt my body was trembling. I knew it was the same symptom before Jesus took me to heaven. Lord took me to heaven right away. Jesus welcomes me. He walked a couple of steps holding my hand. He then held me in his left arm and walked up the stairs of the huge sanctuary. Jesus, what did you bring me here for today? Wrapping my shoulder with his arm and walking along, he said,
You need to write about the error of Roman Catholicism. As I said before, I brought you here to move you.
Jesus, tell me about the writing by Mother Teresa.
You can ask her yourself. Let's go.
As soon as he finished those words, we were standing in front of the school building I saw before. Mother Teresa was doing something with her back showing to us. I was opposite to her with Jesus standing a little bit afar and watching us without saying a word. I was about to say hello, but praise the Lord came out of my mouth. She answered me back praise the Lord, smiling. That day, she was wearing a nun dress habit. Everyone is allowed to live his or her life the way he or she wants in heaven. Just like Peter finds a crown bothersome and refuses to wear one, Mother Teresa still loves to wear a nun dress she used to wear in this world. Come to think of it, my mom was always in hanbok she used to love in this world. I read an article about the absence of God. Would like to talk about it?
As you know, I had served people. However, I always felt spiritual emptiness that would not be filled with my work. I often felt a risk that service people would not guarantee me getting to heaven or meeting Lord. I wrote down what I was thinking regarding those issues, but people would interpret in different ways according to their understanding. Now that I'm in heaven, I realize why I felt such emptiness. I used to pray to Mary on the one hand and Jesus on the other hand. The emptiness I felt stemmed from Holy Spirit feeling sorry for me when I called out Mary. It also derived from the fact that Mary occupied the space that should have been filled with Jesus. Lord knew my love for him. It is his grace that allows me to be here today.
Turning my head to the left and looking at Jesus, I asked Jesus, Don't you think that Mary should say something at this point? She was still taking care of aborted children inside the building. There were some children lying in rows and other children rising up from the land. He was bending over to catch the ladder and laying them down one by one. I could feel what she was feeling. She was aching deeply. As I got close to her, she turned around and smiled at me. You saw me in a discussion with a sister who goes to a Catholic church, didn't you? She told me that Mary was resurrected and went up to heaven. Can you explain about it? She wore a perplexed facial expression that I saw before once again and then said,
My body died in the world, and my soul resurrected and went up to heaven. However, it does not especially concern me but everyone including Peter and Paul who served Jesus in the world.
The same experience will be shared among those who received Jesus Christ in the world and passed away. Their bodies will die, and their souls will resurrect and ascend up to heaven like Jesus.
Then why is it that Roman Catholicism talks about the resurrection and ascendance of only Mary and deify her?
That is the strategy of Satan. It felt a need to present an idol as a strategy after Antichrist. It used me to deify a human being so that it could brainwash and train people to serve a human being instead of Lord.
At that moment, I turned my head and asked Jesus, Lord, talk about the statement the Pope made a while ago. Why did he make such a statement? My questions concerned the statement that only Roman Catholicism is the true church by Pope Benedict XVI. Regarding the issue, Jesus said in a resolute tone,
it is one of Satan's strategies to establish a world government. Roman Catholicism is showing its true colors to advocate and help him before Antichrist appears. Calling Mary was a practice to serve Antichrist as an idol. Now they declared that only Roman Catholicism is the only church in order to muster strength and force to establish a world government.
Lord, save the souls in Roman Catholicism. Jesus said,
didn't I tell you? I never lose a soul that belongs to me. It is your role to spread the book among them diligently. I will make claim to the souls of my people reading the text and save them.
The souls saying Ave Maria, Holy Mother in Roman Catholicism will go to hell after they die. Lord's heart is for the lost lamb. He let me know how the shepherd would feel when looking for a lost lamb, leaving 99 lambs behind. I earnestly hope that they will listen to God's voice, undo what they have done, and enter the kingdom of heaven in the name of Jesus Christ. John the Apostle. Ah, John the Apostle. I want to see him. Where are you now? The moment those words came out of my mouth, I acquired knowledge. He was staying at his house in third heaven.
I can ask him to come over here. But how about us visiting him?
Jesus flied me to third heaven. That was the most beautiful place in heaven. During the flying while, I saw the field, hill, and long white walls I saw the day before. The home of John the Apostle was situated deep in a valley. Like in first or second heaven, there were many houses of different brightness, sizes, and shapes according to the reward. As I learned from Jesus, the higher the reward get, the house would be located in the deeper inside of heaven. People who has more God's love inside the soul like John the Apostle, the more steeples in the house would have. His divine nature lightened up the house even brighter. The entire castle was his house. It was decorated with gorgeous jewels all around. A powerful and bright ray of light was coming out of the house. It was sublimity itself. I stood still at the sight of such sublimity, not knowing what to do. Jesus beside me said,
the light comes out of his clear and deep spirituality.
I did not ask him to go inside. I would not dare to ask such a favor. Now I realize that I did not have faith and spirituality that would allow me to endure such light or look into the inside. I also realized why my mom would not say a word to me and why those living in first heaven like my mom would not come here where it was bright. Unlike me, they left their flesh bodies in the world and became the residents of heaven as spiritual beings. Humility is the first merit that is automatically given by God when one becomes a resident in heaven whether he or she wants it or not. It is the basic mindset for the ruled by God in the kingdom of heaven. Those who showed no respect to God due to their arrogance, ignorance, and foolishness, died and came to kingdom of heaven thanks to God. They would tend to be speechless. God made such fantastic preparations for them without their awareness even though he was ignored and neglected by them. How shamed and sorry they would feel. In addition, they had no accumulation of knowledge of God in the world. It was only natural that their spirituality was not shining bright. It was their humility as the residents of heaven that they would not go to bright places. This is the heaven that one's rewards are graded forever. It is also the God's righteousness to give them back according to their deeds.
Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Matthew 5:11-12.
Jesus called him softly John. John the Apostle would come out running and knelt before Jesus with respect and love. He then kissed on Jesus' hand and feet. Among the people I met, there was no one who expressed his love for Jesus as passionately as possible like him. He was very active and made me realize that love should be expressed like this. Jesus actively expressed his love for mankind and willingly sacrificed on the painful cross. I was learning about a new different aspect of love through him. Realizing love, he continued to talk about the love with the gospel according to John and letters of John.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. John 3:16. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. 1 John 3:16. Dear children, let us not love with words or speech but with actions and in truth. 1 John 3:18.
John the Apostle came up to me, bent over, and kissed on my hand. I hugged him. You were in Patmos Island when writing the book of Revelation, right? I was happy with the heaven description at the end of the book and very much scared of the tribulation parts in the middle of it.
When I first saw that, I was also very scared and trembling hard.
Will those who received Holy Spirit go through the tribulation?
Those who love Lord and those who are loved by Lord will suffer from hardship very lightly if they enter. They will not go through the 7-year great tribulation. Lord will calling them before the 7-year great tribulation. They will be ready as brides and spread the last gospel with the love given by Lord. Then, they will be lifted in a cloud simultaneously.
Then what kind of people will be left in great tribulation? Will they include those who received Holy Spirit?
There are few believers are left also in order to help others with God's permission.
What kind of people will be left behind generally?
They will include those who listened to God's voice and regarded it as a joke, or refused to believe it. They will be subject to severe, harsh, and deep suffering in the Great Tribulation.
Martyrs during tribulation. I was having a conversation with believers. I felt a huge tremble. It grew more powerful until I could not endure it. All energy slipped out of my body, and Lord took me to heaven once again. Jesus said,
I will show you the punishment that will be applied to those who are left behind during the tribulation.
Soon I saw a scene before me. People were scratching here and there in the body with a painful facial expression. They were covered with black insects here and there, too. The insects got attached to their bodies and bit them painfully. They were scratching the itchy bites, which turned into reddish rashes, which would in turn make their faces swollen like balloons. Lord, will those who were chosen will be left behind and get punishment?
All those who failed to be prepared as brides will be left behind and enter the tribulation. But I will provide them with solid faith to overcome the tribulation. In the end, they will get over the tribulation through the faith I gave them.
Then will those who were not chosen by you go to hell?
What do you think? What do you think I will do with them?
I believe you will save even them, as well. Smiling at me, pleased, he said,
I am full of love and mercy. I will grant my grace of salvation to those who listen to my voice and love me even though they are not chosen by me.
I recalled the parable of wedding feast in Matthew 22:1-14. The people who were invited didn't come. The king asked his servant to invite all in the street. Those who come later were not originally invited but had honor to be in the banquet. The next scene took place somewhere like a prison. The prison building was in a L shape. I was looking down at the yard in the air and saw prisoners standing in a circle. There was a man lying on a cross in the middle of people with his hands and feet tied. Evil men tried to saw him half in the stomach and kill him. The prisoners in the surrounding were also shaking with fear.
I will make some of them grow in faith further and die martyrs. I will give them the glory of martyrdom. The faith of the left behind people will get stronger through the martyrdom.
Lord would pour down faith for him to die martyr when the sawing began. He would then God opened up his spiritual eyes, when he shouted loud, I see Lord standing in glory. Lord is waiting for me, standing by the throne. People who are left behind in the world, look at Lord who is trying to save and wait for us. Hallelujah. He then faced his death in the middle of huge joy and praise. There was a golden wagon in standby beside him already. The messengers of death would sit down with their arms and feet crossed far down the cross and merely look at the scene as if they got nothing to do. It was at that moment that the prisoners grew stronger in faith and started to encourage each other. Lord guides many martyrs to martyrdom for that. They will, of course, receive rewards for glory and nobility as I saw them at the place of martyrdom. Why aren't they thrown in prison?
They are in prison because they refused to receive a mark on the forehead. Believers refused to receive a mark on the forehead.
Does that mean it is 666? Not answering the question, he said,
a microcomputer chip will be installed in their foreheads. Those who do not have the mark will have a difficult time eating, dressing, and drinking. However, those who were chosen by me will know it in advance and refuse to accept the mark, going through some difficult hardship regarding eating, dressing, and drinking.
I was shown with a vision about people getting the mark on the foreheads. It looked like a device to scan barcodes at the counter and was smaller than it. The device beamed at someone's forehead, and the subject showed no indications on the surface. A little bit later, the evil people began to identify those who were not marked. Of those who refused to receive mark, some would escape to fields and mountains to avoid the evil men, while others would be captured and sent to prison.
My children I chose will never be taken by the evil force, not even a single person.
At that moment, I knelt down before him and praised him as follows. Lord, your mercy endures forever. Glory be with you forever. Dr. Luke. Lord came to me when I was praying with lying down. My spirit was soon taken to heaven. I thought we arrived in heaven only to find myself in bewilderment. The things before me do not look like something from heaven. I thought I was shown some scenes at other places than heaven because it seemed like a street that had nothing to do with heaven. There were high-rise buildings along the four-lane road and buses and taxis, which I was not sure would run. Buildings had a sign promoting a dentist office or beauty salon. Then I heard God's voice saying,
"It is the lowest area and second heaven."
I automatically knew that the area I was looking at was in a higher graded place than the place my mom lives. Then I heard God's voice again.
"It is the place where those who had sudden death. They received Holy Spirit but had little spiritual knowledge, thus being perplexed in heaven at first. This place provides them with an opportunity for them to continue to do the work they did in the world and gradually get to know the heaven. Once they are filled with knowledge about God in heaven, they will voluntarily leave the place."
Looking down the street, I recalled the time when I asked Jesus about a barber shop in front of the daycare center. I realized that it was the place he said they would not go to after some time in heaven. Looking down the street, I had this sudden urge to see Dr. Luke. Dr. Luke indeed appeared before me. He was bald with black beard on the chins. His nose was long and slim. His eyelids were thin and long. Dr. Luke came out into the street I was looking at. He held out his hand for a handshake. Holding his hand, I asked, "I like the Gospel of Luke the best. What are you doing in here?"
"I went there to treat people."
"Treating people?" I wondered if it was heaven really. "What do you mean treating? I understand there is no sick person in heaven. Then why do you need treatment and hospital?"
"Of course, we don't,"
he continued with his explanations.
"People living in that area in heaven sometimes go to hospital not to have their illness treated but to have their souls treated."
"I heard that everyone in heaven does what they want to. Dr. Luke, who was a doctor in the world, served as a doctor even in heaven and was having a good time doing the job. Paul the Apostle was writing a book at the library. I wondered what I would enjoy doing in heaven with my eyes closed. I naturally smiled. I cannot wait till I get to heaven, Tilda." After finishing the words, Dr. Luke gave me a syringe. I had no idea with what to do with the syringe. "Why is there a syringe in heaven? What is this syringe for?" Dr. Luke took out some roll out of his right hip pocket. When he folded out the black roll, small syringes appeared on it. The roll was as wide as a span. Somebody must be wearing it usually. He would take out a syringe and write down a name on it, which contained some yellow liquid. I recall that injection of joy, injection of praise, injection of peace, injection of wisdom and injection of knowledge were written on the syringes. I was shot by the syringe with injection of peace written on it.
Those who just arrived in heaven and received education, their souls become gradually desire more. They wish to rejoice in Lord, praise Him, and learn about Him more. When they come to me and ask for joy, I will give them injection of joy. When they come to me and ask for praise, I will give them injection of praise.
February 21, 2007. It was soon after I took off flying into the sky that I spotted the white, low, and long stone walks in third heaven and the great-looking castle-like house of John the Apostle. My new house was situated rather inside on the left. It was originally completed, but I wanted a new look or remodeling. At the end of the rooftop on the left side, it was a three-story house with a steeple that I saw at the house of John the Apostle. It belonged to someone who gave up the right to own the house. As he or she refused Lord, I got to have the house.
There are many people who are asked but few people that are chosen. One can be asked to serve as a daughter, queen, or servant. If he or she refuses the job, he or she can face a tragic result of losing all benefits.
For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. Matthew 25:29.
As Jesus showed me the new house, my mood lightened up. Lord and I were flying in the sky and putting on an air show. Looking around, I spotted the area where my mom lived and heaven's wall beside it. Suddenly a strange scene folded out. I saw a group of people standing outside the heaven's wall and gate. They looked so shabby, haggard, and pale. They looked wilted like those in line before the shelter for the poor. They were in yellow rami or hemp clothes. I got very curious as I was looking down the situation in the sky along with Jesus. Jesus, who are they?
They are those who received Holy Spirit but did not work or received a royal gift but buried it in the ground.
I recalled a servant who buried a talent in the ground and was reproached.
And throw that worthless servant outside, into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Matthew 25:30.
Jesus said,
I will build my church high here and gather believers from all over the world.
Saying those words, he stood up and looked extremely big with his arms spreading like a cross. He was so huge that I could not raise my head and look at him. Winged angels were playing the long bugle both on his right and left like in paintings. I had no idea when they made the preparations. The angels were in line from right to left and played the bugle. They were definitely equipped with a belt around the waist. Time was almost running out, and it seemed very urgent. They all started to praise Lord together. Lord will come in a cloud. Lord will come quickly. Amen, amen, and hallelujah. The hell. After the angels finished praising, Lord took me to hell right away. He first showed me a place dealing with those who were obsessed with sex. There were naked people tangled together in a large round container, screaming loud. The container was jam-packed with so many people screaming constantly. A disc made of black iron, which looked like the ladle to make a Chinese stuffed pancake, was hitting them by dropping on them. The iron bar at the center of the disc was in operation, moving up and down. The cast iron disc was striking them hard. The striking speed was slow at first and very fast later. Every strike resulted in the burst of flesh in every direction and their screams. The flesh would then return to the bodies and keep attached to them until another strike hit them. The repeating tramping sound filled the place along with their screams.
Therefore God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. Romans 1:24. With eyes full of adultery, they never stop sinning, they seduce the unstable, they are experts in greed and accursed brood. 2 Peter 2:14.
What he showed me next was a male homosexual. There was a thick iron rod stuck in the anus of the naked man. The iron rod was so long that it would stick out of his mouth. It seemed to bend. He was surprisingly hanging in the air and was tortured in that position. He was beside himself due to pain. The devils were laughing at him, holding a spear below him. One of them cut his penis out with a spear right away. He screamed in such horrible pain and twisted his body. A new penis would keep growing out in the old place. The devils were playing with the cut penis, made fun of him, and played tricks on each other.
In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful acts with Romans 1:27. In a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. They serve as an example of Jude 1:7.
What he showed me next were female homosexuals. I saw two naked women. One of them was bound onto an interrogation chair with four limbs spreading out, and the other was hanging down from an iron wire with four limbs also spreading out. Cutting out the breasts and vagina of the lying woman, the devil said, "You lesbians don't need them, do you?" They cut the woman in a vertical line from the mouth to the vagina. She was screaming hard and fainted. The hanging woman was tortured in a similar way. She had her breasts and vagina cut out and her stomach cut in half. The devils pulled down her the intestines bursting out of her cut stomach, chewed them, and put them back in her stomach in the process of having fun.
For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against. Romans 1:26.
What he showed me next was children who did not believe in Jesus. Jesus, at which age should children start to believe in you in order to avoid hell?
I once told you.
Then I vaguely recalled an episode at the bank the day before. I was waiting in line at the bank and thinking about children. I was in heaven. Suddenly I wondered how young should children be to enter the kingdom of heaven? My answer was 7 then. I thought it was just my curiosity. I never imagined it was a guidance from Holy Spirit. Jesus reminded me of the day at the bank. It is the proof that Lord keeps his eyes on every single move of ours, checks every idea, and answers them. Jesus told me that children under 7 would enter the kingdom of heaven regardless of whether they believed in him or not. Once they are older than 7, they will be thrown into hell if they do not believe in Jesus. Since he provided no explanation why the criterion was set at 7, I have no idea. I am just saying what I heard. Children older than 7 were jam-packed in a pit. They were begging by rubbing their hands, crying hard on bent knees. I was wrong. I was bad. Please, forgive me. Huge fireballs were shot out of the wall behind them like a flamethrower. The children would then move around to avoid the hot fire and suffer from the heat while they kept begging on bent knees. Boys aged 13 or 14 were subject to another type of punishment. A hacksaw would cut their heads above the ear line. The boys would scream, cry, and beg, saying they were bad. The cut head would grow back on and on, which put them under the same repeating punishment. Older children had to receive such double punishments.
Little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous, the one who practices sin. 1 John 3:7-8. Dear children, keep yourselves from idols. 1 John 5:21.
What he showed me next was those who loved money and had a flattering tongue. He told me that they denied Jesus and hid they loved him because of money in the world. They had their tongues pulled out long. They were sitting in such an uncomfortable way with the neck protruding far. Their tongues were pulled down and placed on a plate on which the blacksmith would hit iron. The devils would hammer their tongues down with iron skewers stuck in them. They could not scream, only shedding hot tears. What he showed me next was a group of people who were walking around those who were being tortured in a line. They looked like skeleton samples in a row. They kept walking with no energy, their hands dropped down, their necks were pulled out, and their legs were bent a little. Why are they in such a state? They are like zombies who hate to work.
For even when we were with you, we gave you this rule. The one who is unwilling to work shall not eat. 2 Thessalonians 3:10.
The end. A man appeared to me. It was Joseph, the prime minister of Egypt. Joseph, the son of Jacob, was wearing colorful clothes, waved a fan in the left hand, and looked at me smiling as if he were a 17-year-old boy. He waved his right hand, saying hi to me. A couple of people were passing by as if they were on an escalator commonly found at an airport. They were those who I met before, including Abraham, Peter, David, Paul, Luke, and so on.
Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, Hebrews 12:1.
I heard some loud recitation somewhere.
Do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is near. Revelation 22:10.
The praises and trumpets sound resonated throughout the heaven.
I will come in the clouds, I will come quickly.
Suddenly, my room was lit up with a light which looked like fire. Immediately my fear vanished, and I saw angels descending and walking in my room. I could hear them clearly speaking to each other, and suddenly a marvelous being appeared, more marvelous than the angels. He was dressed in white with a golden sash. On his chest was written in gold, "Faithful and True." His face was showing gentleness and love. Jesus the Christ was in front of me, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Blessed be his holy name. Jesus approached me, touched my head, and told me, "I am Jesus who died for you. Look at these marks in my hands. They are still there for you. I came down from my throne of glory to speak to you. There are many things in your life to put right. You are lazy and quick-tempered. Moreover, I do not want 25% Christian, nor 95% Christian, but 100% Christian. If you want to go to heaven, you have to be holy, as I myself am holy. I came to take you for a journey." I asked him, "Lord, is it a missionary journey?" He answered, "No." Then he took me by my hands and lifted me up and talked to me with simplicity and love. He brought me as far as my windows. He looked at the city of New York, and I saw sadness on his face. He wept and said, "My word is well preached, but people do not listen. The sin of this city has reached my father." The city was full of homosexuals. Among them were politicians. The Lord told me, "It's another Sodom, but I am alive, and the judgments of my father will soon fall on this city." Then I knelt before the Lord while crying, and he told me, "Do not be afraid. When judgment falls on this world, my church will no longer be on the earth." The Lord told me again, "I who give life, I take your spirit, but you will come back and tell the peoples to trust me fully. The one who believes in me will never die." He stretched his hands, and I saw that another body came out of me. I was dressed in white, and I was shining like the Lord. He told me, "Look, this is the body that Christians who obey my word will soon have." I realized that I could go through walls. The Lord who was holding me by my hand said, "Look." When I turned, I saw my body without spirit. He explained to me that my physical body was worthless. It is nothing but dust, and at death it will become dust again, as any physical body. He added that the new body that I had was a glorious one, which is the spirit he gave to man. I thought he would lead me straight to heaven, but it was not the case. We descended through a tunnel below the earth, and when approaching a certain place, I could perceive an unbearable smell. I said, "Lord, I don't want to go into that place." But we went in. That place was dark and not worth living. I heard people suffering, weeping, and screaming. When we got to the end of the tunnel, we sat on a rock, and the Lord told me, "Look." I saw people suffering. In hell, people spend their time crying, and no one cares about others. Dear brothers and sisters, I just came to realize that hell is real. I wept and wept, and when I looked at the Lord, he told me, "Hold on to what you have seen, and do not forget it." I was looking at hell, and people were screaming, "Ouch! Ouch! It's forever! It's forever! Pain and hatred forever!" Then the Lord showed me thousands of people who were suffering in hell, and he told me, "You see, some of these people knew me when they were on the earth. There are still a lot of people on earth who walk on the street without knowing where they go. Know that the way to heaven is very narrow, and it will be even narrower still. There will be difficulties on earth, so that you will be as pure as gold, but fear not, for I am ahead of you like a mighty warrior." I asked him, "Are these Christians in hell?" He answered, "Yes, do you know why? They believed in me, but they did not walk according to my word. There are many, those Christians who only behave well when they're in the temple, in front of their pastors and their family, but they are greatly deceiving themselves. The eyes of my Father see everything, and he understands every word, wherever you are. Tell my people that it's time they lived a holy life before my Father, before the devil, and before the world. Let the devil have no right to accuse my people, and let the world not point the finger at my people. It is high time that we sought holiness and consecration." Then we went somewhere where there was a lake of fire. As we were approaching the lake, I perceived a very bad smell, and the Lord told me, "What you see there is a lake of fire, which is already prepared for the devil, the false prophet, and the Antichrist. I did not prepare this place for men, but all those who do not believe in me as their Savior, and all those who do not live according to my word will go there." At that moment I saw Jesus weeping, and he told me again, "There are too many those who are lost than those who go to heaven." Then Jesus showed me the number of people who were dying in a minute, and he told me, "Look, look how many are lost. My church is sleeping despite the fact that she has received my power. She has my word and the Holy Spirit, but she is sleeping. On earth there are people who preach that hell doesn't exist. Go and tell them that this place is real." I was very far from that place, but I could feel the heat. We left the Hades and went to heaven. We kept on going and went to the second heaven. In that heaven the Lord showed me the sun and the stars, and he told me, "Look at these stars. I call each of them by its name. Do you see the sun? It's by my power that it shines both on the righteous and the wicked. But there will come a day when the sun will no longer shine and everything will be darkness." We went further and reached the heaven where God lives. There were beautiful houses there. The walls of these houses were very high, of pure gold and of precious stones. There were 12 gates of pearl, with 12 angels at the gates. I thought I couldn't go in, but the Lord looked at me and said, "Do you want to go in?" "Oh, yes, Lord, I really want to." "Then get in, for I myself am the door." At that moment, I went in through a precious gate, and I saw a garden of magnificent flowers. "Do you want to go in the garden? Then go in, for I prepared this for you and my people." I stepped in, and I started to pick some flowers and to arrange some bunches. As I was running in the garden like a little girl, the flowers I picked had many colors with a very nice smell. After that, the Lord called someone. It was an angel, strong and so beautiful that I couldn't even describe it to you. The Lord told me, "Do you see this one? He is the Archangel Michael. He is the one who leads my army. Look again." I saw a mighty army on horses, and the Lord told me, "It's not a human army, but my Father's. This army is at the disposal of Christians who are really born again. Do not fear, for it is more powerful than the one which is in the world." Then he showed me another angel. "This one is the messenger of Christians who obey my word." I was happy to hear that. Jesus told me, "Pay attention. I am the God of Abraham, the God of Moses, the God of Elijah, the one who caused fire to fall down from heaven. I have not changed. I am going to show you the condition in which my people live in these last days they've got left." The Lord told me, "Be very careful about the things I'm going to show you." I saw Christians who were weak and tired. The Lord asked me this question, "Do you believe that I can take this church away in its present state?" Then he told me, "Christians that I will take away with me will be glorious, triumphant, spotless, blameless. Among my people there are lies, lack of love. My people are divided. I showed you the condition of Christians in these last days. Now I'm going to show you how the early church lived." Those brothers and sisters were filled with the glory of God. They constantly fasted and prayed. They preached my word without any fear. Whereas present Christians think that I've changed, they also think that the Holy Spirit has changed. The big mistake of Christians today is the fact that they live a routine life, planned by humans. Therefore, they've forgotten that the messages are from the Holy Spirit and from above. Tell my servants, the pastors, that the time has come to put behind those routine programs. If they do, you will see the power of God in your midst, the Holy Spirit who is manifest in the early church. He will perform signs and miracles and wonders in great numbers, causing the dead to rise. The Holy Spirit is still the same. It's you who have changed. Christians, it's high time that you came back to the life of the early church. I then left this beautiful garden and went to the lovely street of gold, and the Lord told me, "Touch! Yes, it's pure gold. Go and tell my children that very soon they're going to walk on these streets of gold by the hand of the one who gives life." Oh, how great it is to walk in those streets of gold. After that, I saw a splendid throne surrounded by angels, archangels, and seraphs. They were continually praising God, the one who was on the throne, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are filled with His glory. Amen." Time has come to lift up holy hands unto me and to praise me. At the same time, I saw the river of the water of life flowing from the throne. I also saw the tree of life, and at the other end I saw the rainbow and the river of crystal. Then I asked the Lord, "Who is on this throne?" He answered, "It's my Father, the Lord of hosts." I told him, "Can I see the Father?" "No, it's not yet time," the Lord answered. Even though I did not see the Father, the one who was on the throne was mighty. I saw thunder and flashes of lightning coming from the throne, and I heard praises. Jesus told me, "Do you hear these praises? These are the praises of those who are redeemed." I saw seven angels, each one of them holding a golden bowl, and seven other angels, each holding a trumpet. "Lord, who are these angels?" The Lord answered, "The seven bowls that the angels hold are filled with the wrath of God. They will soon be poured out, and when the trumpets sound, my church, those Christians who live according to the will of my Father, will be caught up. They will no longer be on earth during the great tribulation. Before the Antichrist manifests himself, this man of sin, my church will hear the last trumpet sound, and they will meet me in the air." I was there, dear friend, in front of a great throne, and I did not have any notion of time. A moment later, Jesus showed me how his church, the true believers, will be caught up. I saw this in vision, thousands of people disappearing. This happened worldwide, and TV and radio gave the news of the disappearance. Newspapers with big headlines in red also brought out the news. The Lord told me, "The news will soon happen. If the judgments of my Father have not yet come upon the earth, it's because of the faithful Christians who really love me." After that, I saw the appearance of the man of sin. He was saying to the inhabitants of the earth, "I'm bringing you peace and safety." And immediately people forgot the event that had just taken place. Jesus told me, "Look carefully." I saw in the vision the seven angels with the seven bowls. Dear friend, what was happening was difficult to describe. I saw the angels pouring out the seven bowls of wrath on the earth. Trumpets started sounding. God was pouring out his judgments on the inhabitants of the earth, and the whole country and whole countries disappeared. The Lord told me, "Look, all these people were part of my church, and some were even pastors." Because I did not fully understand this, I asked the Lord, "How is it that your people have been left so numerous in the great tribulation? How is it that there are also pastors among them, those who preach your word?" Jesus answered, "Yes, they had preached my word, but they were not living in accordance with my word." Then the Lord allowed me to see another multitude of pastors. He told me, "Those pastors were not preaching my word as it is written. They thought that my word was not adapted to their century. They had too much favor towards those who were given a lot of tithes because they were more interested in material prosperity. Go and tell my servants that I am the one who called them, and that silver and gold belong to me, and I give them according to my greatness and glory. Tell them to preach my word as it is written. There are many those who give another interpretation to my word, My word is my word, and no one can change it. It must be preached as it is written. There are many among my people who distort my word for their own profit. After that, we entered a lounge in that New Jerusalem, and the Lord told me, "What you see is paradise." The Lord called a very beautiful woman with an unspeakable beauty, like all those I saw there, and he told me, "This is Mary. Go and tell everyone that Mary is not the Queen of Heaven. The King of Heaven is I, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who says, 'I am the way, the truth, and the life.' Go and tell this blindfolded generation that there is no purgatory, for if there was one, I would have shown you. Instead, there is a hell, the lake of fire, the precious Jerusalem, and the paradise which I've showed you. But tell them that there is no purgatory. Tell them that it's a lie from the devil and there is no purgatory.